Hunting League, week 6, day 2, joined here by Noxious once again and Amaz. How's it going?
Doing fine. Still happy to get some games today. We're like almost done with week 6, and I think at the end of this week, we basically have only 1 week to go, so this will be like the biggest, those are I think the biggest matches for the teams involved.
Yeah. How about you, Amaz? You ready to cast some Nihilim versus Tempo Storm?
Yep. I just got wrecked in ladder. I think my opponent played Void Caller, and then he sacrificed it. I was playing Hunter, right? And then Morgana's popped out.
Oh my god.
And then he facelessed it, and then I was like, okay, I'm done. So hopefully that happens in one of these matches. That would be really cool.
Yeah, faceless is back. Let's do it.
Yeah, I kind of have some doubts that people are playing too experimental the decks. Consistency is a pretty big thing in this term. I think especially. Yeah, especially for Nihilim, if you look at the standings, you know, they're pretty far ahead. I think if they just win like one more set, either this week right now against Tempo Storm or perhaps next week, I think that's good enough to guarantee top two spots, which already advances you to the live finals, which is basically as good as you can place in terms of the first stage of the tournament, which would be closing up next week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess in a $250,000 tournament, you would prefer consistency over, you know, experimental decks, even though, you know, it could be tell good stories, be really cool. You still want to win this. The title is worth it.
Yeah. Team Celestial, though, has nothing to lose next week. So hopefully we see some serious stuff.
Okay. Yeah. Also nothing to gain.
You know? Right.
Yeah. No, they have all the world to gain, you know?
Oh, that's true. Actually, they could gain some pride if they like completely smash, right, you know, their opponent next week. That could happen. Yeah. So how would that happen? The formats. Just if you guys are watching for the first time, how this works is, it's team versus team format. There's 3 players on each team. Each player brings 2 decks, 6 decks total. So it's a best of 11 conquest format, and it's a blind pick, of course. One interesting little rule is the benching rule, which we had a little bit of a disagreement yesterday, but I'll back down. It's your tournament. I'll believe you.
Okay.
Master Amaz.
Wait, so you want me to explain it or do you want to explain it?
Oh, I'm pretty sure I got it. And if I don't, you can just.
Okay.
Just go ahead. Correct then.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So the bench rule is if a player, loses twice in a row, someone else on his team has to win before they can play again.
Yes, that's exactly
perfect.
It.
Very nice. Yeah, like, oh, man.
Yep.
Okay, that's really nice. That's exactly it.
Flawless.
Flawless. All right. So as you guys saw, as far as the standings, doesn't really matter that much if Nihilim loses. They're still in a really good position, but it's a pretty big win. If Tempo Storm gets it, it will be their 4th point. So pretty decisive match for Tempo Storm. Like, if they lose this, you know, it might be really tough to make it through those top 2 spots next week. We'll get started in the games, but before we do that, let's actually take a look at one of the Tempo Storm member for player spotlight. We have Gaara.
Hello everyone, I'm Gaara. I'm from Team Tempo Storm. I'm there from the very beginning. I'm the most known for to be a Hunter player, I think, and a slow control player. And my first popular deck was Ramp Druid, with which I won the first Dreamhack. I think it's like a very interesting format. I think it favors teams that have players with similar playstyles. Like, for example, if you have like a bunch of rogue players in the same team and you figure out a good rogue play so everyone can play the deck. I have like a different opinion compared to the general opinion. And I think that the general opinion would be that Grim Patron Warrior is the strongest deck. So I have to go with that. I hope I can show you some high quality games. And I hope you will enjoy it. And thanks for sticking around and following me, I guess.
Okay, we're back.
Okay.
How about
Yep.
All right, guys. So Nihilum versus Tempo Storm. Let's see the decks that are in here. Typically, week to week, a lot of these teams bring the same decks. A lot of these teams bring the same decks on the same players, just to keep that same level of consistency, which has worked for 7 out of the 8 teams. A lot of the teams are very close together in terms of their standings. A lot of the play has been extremely competitive. Of course, Nihilum is the one team that's kind of just a little bit ahead of the rest.
By the way, we didn't mention it, but I think Life Coach is out for the day. He's on a flight, and I think Lothar is going to be subbing in, right? Unless I'm mistaken.
Yeah, that's right. Life Coach is just currently on the plane as we speak, so obviously they need to play. And there you go. Lothar's going to be the captain for the day, and he is going to be bringing Paladin and Warlock. How do you think this is going to affect Nihilum as a whole, or if at all?
It's actually a little bit interesting because I wasn't under the impression that Life Coach was their Grim Patron player. Mm-hmm. And I think Lothar is actually a pretty good Grim Patron player as well. So I'm surprised to see RDU kind of take the war. Maybe RDU is like, you know, guys, I'm done playing the garbage decks and having to finish for you guys every week with, like, you know, Paladin and all that other stuff. So maybe it's RDU's time to shine. Actually, I thought out of their whole team in the prior weeks, RDU kind of had the toughest role, and he really made it work, which was the most impressive thing when you're given these garbage decks. Okay, not garbage, but yeah, less than ideal decks.
Sixth deck, right? The last one nobody really wants to be playing.
Yeah, so. Every single week it seemed like he got that sixth deck, and every single week he was up last. But, I mean, every single week, I think in the first 2 or 3 weeks, I think he was the one who closed out the win for.
Yeah, first three. He was just like, we're just gonna bring you last, and RDU is just gonna sweat it out. They have to get their youngest member to do it, which is good on them, I guess. RDU can take the heat. And first match is gonna be Taiju's Druid versus Hype's Warrior, and Hype has been bringing a lot of Control Warrior instead of the Patron.
Right.
It's been like last 3 weeks, I think, that he brought the Control instead. So if that's the case, then Nihilum definitely has the edge in their first game here.
Yeah, I'm pretty interested to see how different maybe his Control Warrior is, because it's one of those decks that right now doesn't, you know how it used to be super standard? There's a lot of tweaks that can be made to the deck because the metagame is so volatile sometimes.
Okay.
So I kind of like Hype just building it. I think he was the first one to bring it in the team league. So
he's the only person.
Trump follows suit.
Oh,
Trump did it. Yeah, he did last week. I think you told me you didn't see the matches, so that's probably why you didn't notice it. But I think very few players did, and it's a pretty solid deck all around. So kind of happy to see it come back.
Yeah. Also, Tempo Storm is coming back from what is tied for the most crushing victory in the tournament so far. Last week, Tempo Storm took Team Liquid to the dumpster, man. 6.
Yeah.
That's vicious.
Yeah, well, it happened yesterday again, right?
Yeah, but that Team Celestial was involved, so.
Okay.
Wow, whoa.
I have not.
All right. That was a pretty tough though. But...
Crib, the Triad is coming for you.
How do we even follow a comment with
that? Yeah, don't set me. All right, well, we have Tyson Druid, which is, I like to see Druid play. It's pretty interesting. Often it is fairly mechanical, like you kind of know what to expect in terms of plays, but I feel from casting Thice over so many months and him playing Druid in almost every tournament I've ever cast, he's really one of the players that produces like plays that seem weird but work in the end. So I think that's really the mark of a very, very good Druid player.
Yeah, well, that's kind of how I think he got popular in the first place. Like, his first appearances back in 2014, like in the VGVN, I think, and the G2A Hearthstone Masters, I think he played a lot of Druid in those cases. So he's been playing that class very consistently for as long as he's been in Hearthstone, basically.
It's also been a really consistent class. Like, not really much has changed. Like, yeah, instead of a Yeti, you play a Shredder. And
Yes.
Sometimes instead of like a Drew of the Claw, you might play a Sludge Belcher based on the meta. Sometimes, you know, those kinds of shifts. Maybe a Spectral Knight. We haven't seen one of those in a while.
Yeah, actually, for the Archon Team League specifically, I think people have been staying away from Druid quite a bit. It's been performing really, really terrible. So even though you say it's a very consistent class, maybe it's just like
for
ladder and stuff like that. It has really good matchups such as like Handlock and like, you know, Control Warrior, but everything else is just like you're coming from behind. We actually have like secret stats that we're tracking. And Druid actually only has a 33% win rate across all league games.
Thais has like 60 plus, I think, with Druid in the league so far. Like, Thais is the only player who seems to be doing very well with it.
Oh.
And with a rough start like he's got right now, like no interface, no wild growth, and a pretty clunky hand, he's going to have to find, I think, a lot better than this to maybe keep up the win rate.
Well, what I meant by that is Thais just brings Druid to, like, every single tournament. That aspect of Thais is consistent. But, yeah, of course, we've talked about how Druid has kind of fallen quite a bit in the tournament so far.
Mm-hmm. Well, here, it's kind of interesting. If Thais expects his patron, he can actually just throw down the BGH. There's actually no targets. But then, obviously, Hype playing so much control where he's just going to keep it and save it for later.
Hype is actually, I think, second best win ratio right now in the tournament. I think he's either 9-3 or 10-3, and it's basically the difference between him and first place, who's Kibler, is he has one extra loss.
Okay, so if Hype actually wins 2-0 here and Kibler might falter a little bit, then Hype actually might take over the Master of Duels title for an extra $5,000.
That would be pretty crazy. Yeah, this is looking not too bad for Hype as well. And we didn't really mention that, but Hype brought Patron this time around as opposed to Control Warrior, which he's been doing throughout the league. Little bit of an interesting note there.
I guess the game plan right now for Thais is to kind of bait out the Execute so that the Ancient of War kind of sticks there. But Hype does have two right now. Although, well, he just drew a weapon, so that's going to be helpful.
Yeah. I mean, the big information here is that no Mission Venter. I don't think I've ever seen that card in Control Warrior.
No.
And it is standard in almost every single Grim Patron list.
Right.
So Hyped having to play that, and it seems like a decent turn 4 play. But I think both players are well aware that Hype is expected to play Control Warrior here, and now Thais knows what's going on.
Yep.
It's a very strong thing as well, you know, to just shuffle up your game once in a while, especially if you master both archetypes. You know, if you're very good at both, then you can actually afford doing so. And Hyped has played Control Warrior in the past. It's not the class that associate the most with him, but he's a very good all-around player. So, and I think I think just being so good at Rogue and Mage means that you have to have a good understanding of Warrior as a whole to really compete with them when they show up, because that's pretty much what we pin him on overall.
Alright, so one execute is used. Thais feels a little bit more, you know, safe with his Ancient of War. And, oh, Harrison Jones is a very good pickup there. So probably a silence on the Acolyte. You don't want the Patron Warrior to draw too much.
Yeah.
Man, double wild growth. That is pretty sad.
A lot of excess mana in his near future.
Actually, would you consider just going for it?
Like going for double wild growth?
Well, you have to keep her first, so maybe you do it next turn to set up a combo because you've got the Savage Roars with the Force of Nature. So there's a possibility.
You don't have a good turn here. Like, just keep her on Acolyte is not particularly good. So if you do double wild growth, you can do Ancient of War next turn, and then you can do combo the turn after.
Wow. I guess that's what he's going to go with.
Job's done. All right, so he's waiting for the weapon. Oh, man. Not silencing that Acolyte is something you're just very unhappy about.
Just cross your fingers.
Yeah.
I don't mind it though. Like, it's such a weak play. I mean, you just continue to lose, and Druid in a losing position is very bad.
Yeah, I guess. But at the same time, like, Keeper is the only real target for Keeper is the Acolyte, anyways. So I guess the bigger reason to do the Wild Growth is to, you know, play the Ancient of War since you just saw an execute.
You know, now that I think of it, the target for Keeper could be a weakened Grim Patron, since Druid has so few ways to kill off the patrons once they spawn.
Okay.
Being able to deal 2 damage to one of them that took only 1 Whirlwind might be enough.
Well, Despite it's equipped here, Harrison looks pretty juicy, but then obviously the Acolyte is going to get a little bit of value.
Nice shade,
with the shade, well, the shade is probably going to be Harrison.
Yeah, that makes it a bit more decisive.
Yeah.
Yeah, what else anyway? Like, it would be pretty much the same play. You're not playing Ancient of War into this? Hmm. Would you?
No.
No, but I mean, like, if you didn't pick up the shade here, you would still go for Harrison Jones, right?
I think Noxious actually has a point. You already saw one execute, and you haven't seen, like, any card draw besides the Gnomish.
Okay.
So the chance he has a second execute is really low. I think he actually is considering the Ancient of War right now.
Well, actually, a lot of things punish you, right? Taskmaster Enrage Acolyte would be so punishing, because the weapon deals 5, and Acolyte's 3, and the 2-4, right? So,
oh, wow, he does not want to give his opponent the card draw from the Acolyte, and he thinks he can get away with waiting one turn before the Death Bite, because he doesn't expect Patrons to come out right now, and if they do, he's got the Force of Nature Savage Roar to deal with them.
Oh, wow.
Okay. What a top deck.
Let's
do that instead.
That's kind of, like, bad, though, because rather than do the Grim Patron in Battle Rage, instead he's going to probably play the Emperor Tharson, and he's going to get punished because he's going to lose his Death Spite. Or otherwise it would have actually worked.
Oh yeah, that's true. But so do you go for the card draw anyways, and then play Emperor next turn so that you have a lot of cards to discount instead?
I don't know, it just looks so... like you got 3 and some card draw worth of combo pieces. It just looks so juicy.
Yeah, I would probably pick it up because I mean, you can still get Emperor with Frothing Berserker value a bit later, and the 2 patrons on their own are going to be annoying enough for the Druid to handle.
4 cards for Battle Rage right now.
Mm-hmm.
That seems like a lot.
Oh, is he going to take just the 3?
Oh.
Or not even? All right.
He'll go somewhere in between. So he does lose the Deathbite, but plays Emperor instead.
Oh, that's pretty sweet. So now he's not vulnerable to weapon hate, but the thing is he doesn't expect it anyway, since Thais, he thinks, would have probably already played it if there were some.
Why did Hype do that? Is that one of those unhappy moments?
No, he's pumped up!
You just have to get up.
his adrenaline is like rushing, man. He just needs to get up and, you know, spend some of that energy.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
All right. Well, Drew the Claw, Savage Roar does clear here. That's not too bad.
Oh. I would just use Force here, to be honest. Because Druid the Claw can actually like kill a patron and still leave a 4-1 body behind.
No, it looks like he's going to play Druid the Claw and Taunt, actually.
Oh.
Yeah, because the Shade trades for Emperor, and you can always tank that 2-3 with the Druid the Claw.
Okay, makes sense.
Or you can attack it as a 4-4, I guess.
It also might even soak up an execute, right?
Right, and that's what you're hoping for, since you've got the Ancient of War, as we mentioned earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Hmm. Oh, God.
Ooh.
Good thing there's no whirlwind effect for Hyped, because Thais would be just blown out of the water here.
Well, there might be. I think he's cast at least one Battle Rage this turn.
Oh, definitely.
All right, goes for the cheaper one first.
Uh-oh. Oh. Not quite there, but...
Here's some whirlwind effects for you.
Mm-hmm. Do you go for the second Battle Rage now, or is that not worth it?
I guess you could. Are you really developing anything this turn?
Probably not, right?
You probably actually just killed the Drew the Claw with a Cruel Task. Oh, maybe not anymore.
Oh, God.
Wow. That's a lot of whirlwind effects. And to be honest, Tesh is only at 17 health, so he's pretty much dead.
The Execute's going to stay in Hyde's hands for now, I think. Unless he wants to go for the Whirlwind Execute right now to set up a cleaner board next turn, but that's a little bit of an overzealous play.
Does he do the Execute play?
No.
No, wow.
He decides he's going to get better value out of having more minions on the board next turn and executing then with the Frothing.
This is where Thais is likely to make a play that we're not going to see. This is often where Thais just makes like a hyper-aggressive, super risky play.
Okay, and what would that be?
The all-in... There's no way he does that, though.
Yeah.
Angriff? Angriff?
Uproot?
Yeah.
It's happening.
Oh, man.
Let it happen. That's
no,
all I'm hoping for, like a big 10-5.
I guess the best move, if we can look at both hands, is just to force the nature clear.
Mm-hmm.
The more minions you put down, the worse it becomes. But even then, it's probably not going to save Taish, because like Hype has like
yeah.
9 mana and then 2 whirlwind effects.
Yeah, things are looking really bad for Taish here.
Yeah, this is pretty much like Hype doesn't have the dream hand, but it's pretty close to that.
What this is the dream hand. I mean, come on.
Yeah,
come
it's missing an inner rage, but
oh,
yeah.
Oh wow, missing. No. This is good enough. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
It has to be lethal here.
I don't think you even need to pay the patron. You can just play like double whirlwind effects with the problem. But well, I guess at this point you can do anything you want.
Yeah, that's the thing. I wondered, then I asked this question to someone else, and I'd have to test, but like, how worse is Patron when you cut Emperor Thorsen? Like, how many losses do you get just because Emperor is not in the deck? That's been one of my questions for a while now about the deck, because it looks like it's getting powered by that card more so than you'd expect it to be.
Yeah, it's actually pretty important, right? All these spells are very low cost. You know, you got Battle Rage, Execute, Whirlwinds, right? I wonder if it'll be different if Emperor cannot reduce cards down to zero.
Well, the thing is, like, with these type of combo decks that work off of so many little things at the same time, because they've reached such a refined stage, I think for it to not be played anymore takes, like, a considerable nerf. Because if you guys remember, like, Miracle Rogue, like, they nerfed Leeroy, so you couldn't do much damage anymore.
Yeah.
And then people still played Miracle Rogue. It took like the extra mana cost on Auctioneer and everyone playing Mech Mage for Miracle Rogue to die, right?
Yeah.
Took a lot of nerfs.
That's and
lot
of Lobber as well. Like between Bomb Lobber for a while, people were like, okay, so Bomb Lobber, we have Lotheb, and now the Gadget Sand's getting nerfed on top of Leeroy.
True,
this is just kind of a mix of really, really terrible nerfs to
you're the right about archetype. That. I remember the Auctioneer Conceal, like the 6-man Auctioneer Conceal getting bomb lobbered.
Yeah, it felt horrible, so the deck eventually just died off immediately.
It feels horrible just thinking about it. All right, well, back to the tournament here. Hype hits up the first point. It's looking pretty good for Master of the Duels, I suppose.
Yeah. Looking pretty good.
Now, coming off of a loss, I don't think it matters too much. Actually, I think it's maybe a bit surprising to open up with the Druid, it being maybe one of the weaker classes overall, as we talked about.
Well, how many good matchups does it have? Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, actually, in the past, players have been queuing their less consistent decks first, just to get a win first. So, like, especially Valuetown, right? They always get Kibler to play Shaman first. So maybe Taish was expecting that. That they just want to go with a weaker class overall first. But, you know, patron win is a patron win, you know? Just get it over with.
Yeah, I could see that. So one of the things, too, with the queuing up with your early classes that are bad is if you can basically smash your head against the wall until you get a win. And worst case scenario, a bench this early might not matter as much because you can still navigate kind of the matchups with your other classes. So maybe that's the reason they tend to queue those. That's kind of an assumption I'm making.
Well, in the dream situation, you kind of want the your worst classes to just take a win immediately, like sneak a win, and then have more chances for your consistent classes, right? Like Patron Warrior, sure, you're going to kill yourself sometimes with bad draws, but like with the number of games that you're going to play, it's going to get a win sometime. So yeah, it's a valid point that you want to, you know, queue with your weaker classes first because you have to win with everything anyways.
I'm kind of curious to see stats on like the opening deck because just going off like a feeling, it seems like Patron Warrior has opened up a lot of tournaments so far.
Yeah, a lot. We have a lot of Freeze Mage versus Patron Warrior opening. And I guess the other side of the argument is that you want momentum, right? You just want to win first and then demoralize your opponent, make them play around the bench rule and you know, win that way. But Taish is going to actually go again. And once again, if he loses, then he's going to be benched until someone else wins a game from his team. He can't be able to play. And he's going to match up against Eloise's Warlock.
Yeah, it's a pretty good matchup. I mean, if you're playing Mage, I think any Warlock is fine. Is there even a Warlock matchup you don't like as Freeze Mage? If we're assuming he's playing Freeze.
Not even Freeze Mage, right? I mean, Temple Mage is good against Handlock. Temple Mage is good against Zoo. I mean, it's all just fine.
Is Temple Mage good against Handlock?
Temple Mage is great against Handlock. You get two fireballs. Like, you have so much burst that their Molten Giant is effectively useless, right?
That's true, but I feel like some of, like, you know, there's Tempo Mage, like pure Tempo Mage, and there's like all these variants that aren't exactly Tempo Mage, but they have like 26 out of the 30 cards. Mm-hmm. They call them like Flood Mage, right, or like this and that, and those are like really bad against Handlock. I remember actually Reyna talking about that. So I'm kind of curious to see what the small distinction is.
Ooh, we see. Okay, this is Freeze Mage, right?
Yep.
There is still a little chance that it could be Temple Mage, right? Arcane
no.
Lance.
It could be that.
Could be like Grinder Mage.
Tiddler Tempo with Frost Nova and Pyroblast. Remember that?
It could be Grinder, or it could be Control Mage, right? But it's just very unlikely at this stage. I think Freeze Mage has been one of the staple decks for this tournament.
Yeah, and from Thais as well. I mean, it's a deck that he's played very often. RDU and him, I think, are very frequently playing Freeze Mage. One of the things is we've seen Control Mage kind of crop up in the metagame. Not so much in tournaments, though. And I haven't seen anybody bring it just yet. Like, we saw Neria bringing a really weird variant of Echo last week, I think, that just didn't work out at all.
Yeah, he kind of misplayed a little bit there. He was.
Yeah, he could have won. I'm pretty sure he could have won with that greedy Echo play.
Definitely very cool, though. Very, very cool.
Yeah, definitely. So I'm hoping we see some Control Mage, maybe Echo. But those are... they tend to target something very specific, like Warrior, as opposed to trying to run into a wide array of the metagame.
Wow, over at Eluisa is Super Zoo. Super Zoo meaning that's Argent Squire.
It's a pretty good
and
hand for this type of deck.
Flame Imp.
It's actually really good, because, like, once again, like, the Zoo decks right now run Voidcaller and Mal'Ganis, Dr. Boom, and stuff like that, so actually gives up a lot of early aggression. And with this play, you're actually putting 4 power on the board turn 1. Sometimes we don't see that in Zoo anymore, right? We see like Haunted Creeper, Nerubian Egg, they actually don't put pressure on the Freeze Mage at all. So, good deck choice.
I feel like Dr. Boom is actually an extremely powerful card against Freeze Mage.
Yeah, it's insane against them. The thing is, it's so weird because you want to play it on curve, and that's amazing, but sometimes you just want to keep it for later when you've popped the block. Assuming you've got enough power on the board, of course.
Oh, no, you wait. But you just get the mage at like a few life points. And
yeah, exactly.
And Doomsayer to come down. And
yeah,
that's true.
That happens more times than people would like to believe, actually.
Yeah, that's true. Well, here, two choices, really. The 2-1 drops or the single 2 drop. I think I actually like the 2-1 drops a bit better because you put more power on the board.
Yeah, it's also that... just having a lot of one health creatures at the same time makes it so the mage is not likely to ping him down. I mean, he's going to play Acolyte anyway, but if Thais didn't have the Acolyte, he probably would have gone for a ping on the Flame Imp.
What a great draw here for Eloise.
Oh, the Silence was definitely going to be keeping
for Doomsayer
or like a freeze, right? That would be like much more important. Oh, and that is a pretty damn good draw.
Yeah.
What do you mean, getting Mal'Ganis for free is good?
Usually, yeah.
Turns out it is.
Still, I think this match is heavily like Freeze Mage favored, even though things are going really well for the Warlock already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very lopsided for the Freeze Mage, which is why it's kind of nice to see the Warlock for once has a really good momentum at this point. Usually at this point, they've already lost a few minions to Frostbolts and maybe even an Acolyte or Mad Scientist. But she's still on the board and not even getting contested for the time being.
Right.
Well, I think Frostbolt ping here is a reasonable play. Because if you don't do that, you have to play card draw, and card draw is really weak right now.
I like that too, because you just want to stop the bleeding as much as you can. Oh, wow. Just going to go for the card draw. Okay. Taj just feels safe.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, whatever, I've got Ice Barrier and Healbot, that's 16 extra health. Good luck with that, Zoo. But if any deck can put together enough recurring damage, I think it's Zoo.
Do you choose to deal with this Acolyte?
I think you kind of want to do that.
You might sack the Imp, since you basically have nothing else to do with it, and it's likely to die very soon.
Sure.
And you can play just the Voidcaller.
Yeah. Yeah, your Voidcaller is not likely to die. And if you do get like Frost Nova Doomsayer, you can just drop the Voidwalker and get a freebie Mal'Ganis. So
many possibilities. Yeah. And even actually you could even Owl the Doomsayer and do that. Then that way when she like inevitably gets blizzarded, then at least Mal'Ganis is gonna pop out eventually. That's not too bad. I think Eloise can navigate this somewhat, but I think getting through the ice barrier and the heal bot is going to prove to be a bit more difficult than it looks.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so she does go with this play at the end. You know, people make tend to overthink and like make weird choices in tournaments because the pressure is really.
I know all about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The one tournament I played in.
Everybody has some notion of this who's ever played in a tournament. That's absolutely
right.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Well, you can use Arcane Intellect. You'll be at 10 cards next turn.
Yeah, but I guess it's like a delicate balance of juggling card draw with life total, I guess. Your opponent could have some Power of Warmings and Doomguards. Yeah. And as long as you play around the more frequent ones, I mean, obviously you don't expect like Power of Warming, double abusive or something like that.
You just have no way of clearing this board, so I feel like drawing is kind of necessary. I mean, the other play would probably be the Ice Barrier and pinging down the 2-1.
Oh, that's a good card. Oh, Cone of Cold as well.
Wow, this is a really nice card. Actually, Thais is one of the few players that does play Cone of Cold almost every time. Mm-hmm. I've seen him play a lot of it. I think he's the only player that I've seen play Cone of Cold consistently in Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I think Fireback plays a little bit of Cone of Cold, but not every week in Archon Team League, at least.
Oh, that's not bad. So this is probably going to have to be the Voidwalker just because Mal'Ganis is such an important card for you to get out as fast as you can.
Yeah.
It curves nicely with Defend of Argus for survivability purposes.
Yeah, I like it on the Divine Shield and on the Voidcaller. I mean, you want the Voidcaller to die, but you don't really want the Voidcaller to die right away. So just put in a little bit of extra health. Maybe he'll survive a Flame Strike and push for a bit more damage.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty nice.
And this is the moment where the mage can turn the tide, I think.
Oh man, Mad Scientist would be Jin draw there. Mad Scientist basically costs even less than a secret, so... Drawing the ice block is actually unplayable.
Yeah, it's unplayable, but now you have ice block, which is
pretty
nice.
You would be dead to Power Whelming Doomguard right now, actually, if that had been there.
Actually, just the Power Whelming would have done it, right? Because you could have the silence.
Oh right, well...
3, 4, 5?
Well...
No, it would have been a bit short, I think.
Oh, you have abusive. Double owl! Wow. That's pretty decent.
Yeah, you go for it? Do you go for a little bit of extra damage?
You have to silence off your four collar though, so that's kind of awkward.
No, you can hit the Argus.
Yeah, it could, but that's only Battle Cry deal too. I would just play Haunted Creeper here.
Haunted Creeper abusive.
Yeah.
Too late
actually,
for that.
You know what? Maybe just play nothing, right? You want double owls in case you draw Overwhelming and just push through.
Mm. That makes sense. So a defensive owl, well, an offensive owl rather, as opposed to destroying something like a Doomslayer.
Very awkward for Taish here.
You've got to play... So wait, if you have to play your secrets eventually. So do you try to play maybe your barrier now? Or are you going to go for like turn 8, barrier, hailbot in the same turn?
Well, you have the option to Frostbolt, ping, and play a secret. That seems to be a reasonable line of play. I don't know if you want to waste the Frost Nova yet, because you don't have a Doomsayer.
Yeah, if you Frost Nova now, you're just really
going to draw Flame Shirt. Wait, let's look at this. He's got double Frostbolt, double Ice Lance.
Uh-huh.
That is pretty much
a lot of damage, yeah.
Lethal on the Warlock if Alex gets played offensively. He'd have to get there, of course.
Wow, very aggressive here. He has to play an Ice Lance after this Arcane Ult.
Yeah, he's forced to.
Well, there's the other block.
Well, never mind. He's not going to go for the offensive Alex. Man, this is looking so dangerous. So is this block popped?
Well, this is not a block. This is an Ice Barrier.
Is it? Oh yeah, you're right. There's
oh
double,
yeah, sorry about
double
that.
Ice block in hand. I probably misled
triple
you there.
Ice block freeze mage the nightmare. We can make a movie out of that. This is hell.
All right. So what does he have? He has 6 on board, and he has the potential to push for 4 more damage. But I mean, on your first attack, you'd realize it's not really worth pushing for.
Yep.
And he pushed for 3 more than that. Actually, he can get him to 5.
Yeah, get him almost. To lethal, and Thais will only have a heal bot defensively, and he's gonna have to go with Frost Nova in conjunction if he wants to. The thing is, you could just Nova then Alex yourself, but then look at the amount of damage that's going to come out of the zoo player.
I don't know if I like that attack because, like, I kind of like playing the Argus here just to make the Voidcaller survive a Flame Strike if it happened.
Really? I actually want the Voidcaller to die.
At this point, yeah, I think I do too.
Right? You can push 9
so
you, damage.
Oh, so you can get the Mal'Ganis. So you're right. No, you're absolutely right.
My shield for Argus. Oh, but place it over there anyways. Okay.
What?
well then.
One damage missed.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, upwards. Was that
okay, wait. What if it's like a super deep play whereby she's calculating all the combinations of possible ice block, leftover health?
Probably not.
Yeah, okay. Amaz doesn't believe. Okay.
Well, this is a pretty nice play. Picking up the second Frost Nova, you can play that ice block up and Scientist.
Yeah. You're guaranteed
or,
to get a second.
Oh, no. You can ping the Haunted Creeper Frost Nova. And he can't play anything.
Yeah, that's actually really good.
Creep is evil.
No, that's actually the play, right?
Yeah, you're right. Like, there's no way you're going to get blown out by a mix of Fire Warmings and Owl.
Yeah. You can't Owl.
You can't Owl, yeah, you can't Owl.
Yeah, if the board is filled up, exactly. Now there's a possibility that something gets double Power Whelmed into after
the
Owl.
Can we push for a an Ice Block pop here? Not quite, right?
The most damage you can do is 3 base from the Voidcaller and amp it up by 6. So, no.
No, you can't even amp it up by 6. You don't have space.
Oh, yeah. It's
true. Oh, yeah, that's true.
Okay, well.
There's another awkward. 4 then.
Well, I mean, thankfully for Eloise, there's no Doomsayer, right? I mean, if there is a Doomsayer, I'm pretty sure the ping on the Haunted Creeper would have happened, right? So, just to guarantee it.
Well, no, yeah. You can still do that next turn.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, just repeat. Oh, man. This is why it sucks for the zoo against the freeze mage, right? You just feel so helpless. You just can't do anything.
It's closing the game that's really difficult. I feel like you have to find the double power overwhelming sometime in the mid game because that's really what's going to carry you forward. Like, that extra burst is a really big deal.
Well, this out effectively dealt 8 damage.
Oh, man. Emperor Nova? Is that...
Yeah. Oh, Emperor Nova is pretty sick.
Yeah. How does she even deal with that? She can't. Emperor's gonna get another turn, right?
Right. But Dice doesn't like start winning with that. Like,
well, there's a possibility you can then play Alex offensively and then combine your Frost Bolts with a potential top decked Fireball. That's gonna give you the win.
That's exactly the point. He still needs to come up with something in these next few turns. Like, it's looking like Dice has complete control over this game, but if he just blanks out in the next 2 turns, he's still going to lose.
Pretty hard to blank up right now, because all your spells are either AoE damage or just direct damage.
Oh, yeah. Doomsayer is a pretty big blank.
Oh, that's true, yeah. Okay. Well, sad day. End turn. That's the fastest end turn I've ever seen.
Uh-oh. Oh my god.
There we go. And now, because Eloise couldn't play the Imgang boss might just come out instead of Mal'Ganis instead. And that would be like just brutal.
All right.
So you pop the spider and you flame strike?
Wait.
No.
No? Okay. That's what I do. I guess maybe.
You pop the spider?
I would. That way I'm not stuck with 2-1-1s afterwards.
I guess it really depends on what Voidcaller pops up and if you can play around most of the possibilities.
Well, I guess you could always Ice Lance a Mal'Ganis if things go really wrong.
Ice Lance if it goes really badly.
Okay.
You could even Frostbolt Ice Lance and kill it.
Oh, there we go!
I like the Frostbolt Ice Lance, actually.
Frostbolt? Oh, that's actually really good, yeah.
Poor Mal'Ganis did nothing. I am a turtle.
If you're gonna Ice Lance it, just Frostbolting only costs you 3 more damage, and you push for 5 with the Emperor. So it's it's clearly the best play here. Good on Thais here.
Oh. 7 mana, Alex with a 3 mana heal bar. That's 23 health, back to full almost.
Oh wow, that is a good one. Let's do some juggle action.
Yeah.
2 is not that good.
No way. So I was having the discussion, by the way, about Implosion. You know how it's been said that, oh, there's too much variance? If it were 3 damage, 3 imps, would it be too powerful? Because it's too consistent. That's something, because people have said, you know, it should deal, if it deals 4, it should summon 2. If it deals 2, it should summon 4, or, you know, and whatever. But if it dealt 3-3, would it be just too consistently good?
Well, three damage is worth 2 mana, so it's like 2 mana to pop 3 1-1s. So no, actually, I think it's like pretty fair. I think 3 is pretty fair. The fact that the demons actually makes it a little bit OP.
Wow, that's over.
It looks over for the zoo player, yeah, so...
Not well, exactly can, lethal can, yet, but yeah.
Just give it Alex for 1 damage and
No. You just fireball frostbolt and just disable your opponent to tap and you have an ice block up, so just
why don't you Alistraza? You already have an ice block up and your next ice block costs 1 mana. Just Alistraza for 1 damage, put pressure on the board.
What? Oh.
Yeah.
And then you can still frostbolt face. Like he still can't tap and you have an 8/8.
And even anti killbot is fine, to be honest.
This is so ridiculous.
Any line of play here basically can win the game.
Right. Like we're debating over how many angels are gonna fit on the pin of a needle. You don't know that expression?
No.
Really? Okay. So how many angels can fit on the pin of a needle was a famous debate in the medieval era, I think, whereby people start arguing about that stupid question for theological purposes. It's like saying you're debating about useless stuff.
Great.
That sums it up quite well, actually.
pretty much. It's saying like there's absolutely no point to the debate. Uh-huh. So every line of play is a winning play for Thais at this rate, I think.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, Eloise has to be running, I guess. What would be a card that might actually, though very unlikely, be in this deck?
Jiraxxus.
I think a Shredder. She can get a Shredder, Power Overwhelmment, and pull Vitality Totem. There you go.
Jiraxxus, not even save her. Yeah, actually, that's true. Okay. Yep, that's it.
It's on Mystic. Wouldn't even do it either at this point.
Oh, alright, well, there you go. Thais just gonna get a win with the Freeze Mage and avoid the bench.
Yeah. And even it up for Nihilum.
Yeah.
Pretty good stuff.
Freeze Mage, those things, right?
Shown its dominance over the aggressive decks yet again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the different reason people play it, I think. It's just as Amaz mentioned yesterday when we were casting, it's got so many so many polarized matchups that it's bound to run into something it wins.
Yeah, and it seems like if Eloise actually went with a bit more aggressive play like early on instead of the Haunted Creeper, the damage would have ramped up quite considerably, and Thais would have been forced to make like different decisions maybe.
Maybe. I mean, I think even with the most aggressive plays, I don't know if she could have pushed for. I think at the lowest point, Thais is at like
8 life, I think. Yeah, but everything was frozen. Completely frozen.
Slightly sub 10.
Yeah.
It's possible if she was able to proc a block. And I think we're mostly going back to turn 2, where she had the option to do a double 1 drop. Instead, right. She played a Haunted Creeper. If she played a double 1 drop, she probably would have pushed. She may have pushed that difference. I think you might be right. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of hard to analyze because the Haunted Creeper provided nice trades with the Abusive against the Acolyte. So, I mean, if you had all bad things on the board against
Acolyte. But the point is,
maybe you'd drawn more cards. Maybe the Acolyte would have got a kill, so maybe it wouldn't have done more damage. Hearthstone's complicated.
The Acolyte doesn't have taunt, so you have to go for face.
Yeah.
Right? So you're missing more face damage. Playing the Heartkeeper with the Valor Tree actually missed damage, so...
Yeah. There's something to be said, though, about playing very aggressively against Freeze Mage when you're Zoo, because it's almost... Like, you have to almost go all in as soon as you can, given that you can't fight a long game. You're guaranteed to lose that one. So, you know, you've got a point, Amaz. I think going more aggression might have been better.
Well, back to the matchups here. What do you think... it's going to come up next here.
Druid! Let's do it again. Because he avoided the bench, so he could just requeue it if he wants to. And if he runs to the mage from Hyped, that could be a good matchup. Although the rest isn't looking exactly amazing, so...
Yeah, it could really be anything right now.
I think that Druid's going to be a big problem for Thais.
I think the only prediction you might have is it's not that likely that Eloise will play. I mean, she's playing Paladin and Zoo Warlock. That's probably like 2 aggressive decks. And, I mean, if bad things happen, she will be benched. And how many aggressive decks do you still have in the lineup? Like, Hyped is probably playing Freeze Mage. Gar is probably playing like slow decks. Oh wow.
Well, turns out RD is going to be queuing up a good
matchup. I gotta go, guys. I'm being
Well, you know, actually, you know what? That was very good analysis, Crip, because this is a bad matchup for the Warlock, right? Mm-hmm. RD running Hunter instead. So
if they had you for an analyst, man, they wouldn't be in this situation, Crip.
That's right. So
it just feels like if Eloise gets benched, they have very few options to play an aggressive deck, and that gives Nihilim a big advantage.
Yeah. That's right. But then you might be saying that, oh, because Nihilim thinks that, you know, Temple Storm is not going to bring down Eloise, then they might really just do like a double mind games.
Yeah, but the thing is, Gaara was playing Hunter, so they could have played an aggressive deck here without playing Eloise.
That's true. Oh, yeah, in that case, that makes sense. Sure. Double quick shot Hunter for RDU. Interesting. We saw him in one of the weeks play double Hunter's Mark against Trump, and Trump was super surprised
when he thought
that double Molten Giants taunted up were like just safe. And nope.
Generally, you think that.
Yeah.
I mean,
it seems like a good assumption.
Yeah, Trump had a good line of thought.
Right? Yeah.
From the south of it.
Okay.
Can't disagree with that. Now, the question is whether or not RDU is running any type of a slower deck. Oh, that's a good pickup against Zoo.
Oh, Hunter against Zoo is just so good for the Hunter. I mean, endless answers.
It's already pretty good, but if you're running like double Unleash and like one Explosive, it's almost like a sure thing.
Well, Endgame Boss is a good pickup.
Mm-hmm. You can do the Juggler Voidwalker, though. I mean, that's about as good, really.
That's okay. You get punished by exactly what RDU is holding, Unleash the Hounds. But even the Voidwalker soaks
up quite a bit. The Voidwalker would soak up all the doggies.
Yeah, that's true. Well,
yeah, unless there's an Iron Beak with it, pretty much.
Yeah. I don't know. I just love playing Endgame Boss on 3. It's just like default.
It's hard not to do. It's kind of like the Dr. Boom scenario. Like if it lights up on 3, you kind of just play it.
It's so good.
It is really good, but you don't really protect your board at all. Like, your owl dies to the Haunted Creeper. I mean, that's the only thing you have on the board now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's not really good either for Eloise. The bow is such a problem. Because that's the problem with Zoo, is I think, like, between the quick shots that were added to the Hunter's Arsenal recently, that's kind of relative, but with the addition of quick shots, it's giving Hunters a Dark Bomb, and we already know how strong Dark Bomb is. Against aggressive decks, and Zeus suffered from that a while back when it got given to handlocks. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of the same scenario here.
Well, apparently Dark Bomb is not good enough, so you have to, you know, put something extra.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, it's not exactly as awful as Dark Bomb. Yeah.
You know, need a little bit more card draw.
Oh man, if you had the Juggler, called it. There we go.
Creep right, would have exposed the entire board to doggies because it's worth it.
Yep. Well, I guess it's worth it, right? It doesn't really.
It's matter. Good.
You better still protected your board with the Voidwalker a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And it does hit, which is the bow is gonna punish the trade
very, very much.
Wait,
that Doomguard actually has no answers.
Like, actually, yeah.
That's a big problem, because RDU just used the kill command, and there's only so much you can do if you don't have a freezing trap up. And we saw the mad scientist get silenced as fast as she could do it.
And Doomguard being frozen is not even like the best answer to it, right? It just comes back.
Oh, wow.
Ooh, he's going to go for the double quick shot? Or
No. He wants to stab the creeper. Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. I like this. Yeah.
And before Hunter's Mark.
You can see Eloise is not very happy.
No. These two cards are pretty good against Hunter. You don't really want to discard them with Doomguard.
Yeah, definitely not.
Yeah, but I think at 30 life, you know you can tap on 6.
You go turn 4 and then your turn 5 is a little wonky, but your turn 6 is going to be okay.
So you just slam down a Doomguard here?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you can push for damage. Hunter's at 18, you're at 30. You draw 2 cards a turn from now on, and the Hunter is the one who has to try to deal with your board because there's no way he's playing 5 power on his turn 5.
Great point. You're right.
Yeah.
It's unlikely he's going to be able to deal with this. The only time it backfires is when Freezing Trap comes out now, because Doomguard is going to be on 7 instead of 6.
Yeah, it's when that Hunter's Mark pops up. That's when it backfires.
Oh, man. Explosive is good enough, too, to be honest. You might even just fake it. Oh, the fakes.
Okay. I like the speed. It's like, easy play. Easy play. Okay. Low Freeze Trap.
Well, see if it's going to be rewarded.
Yeah.
Okay. That's not bad.
The question is whether or not she's going to... Because I think you can proc a Doomguard. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, imagine she tries.
Imagine she was like clairvoyant. You know, it's like explosive trap for sure. And then, you know, drop down the egg and face of the Doomguard. That'd be a winning play.
Oh my god. Esports.
That is insane.
You gotta continue your bluff here.
You leave the Doomguard.
You can't bluff here, right?
You have to pop the egg and then kill the 4/4 with your hounds if you want to keep the bluff up. Otherwise, like, Abusive Sergeant comes up and then it doesn't look like you're really bluffing.
You're doing this move because it's just the best move, but you can't really bluff because it's...
Clairvoyant, noxious, look at that.
Oh my god, okay. You guys might be right there, I guess.
Oh my god!
What is insane?
I don't even know what's happening anymore.
Okay.
What is this game? Is it Hearthstone? This makes no sense. So, Zoo with an ooze because bad matchups against Hunter and Patron.
Get in there and fight! Okay. I guess, but like, why are you playing Zoo if you want to be Patron? I guess because you have to play everything.
Yeah. Oh,
and now, the Doomguard gets a free kill on the Leoc. Jeez, that's so good.
Yeah.
It is good, but through this whole ordeal, Eloise did 0 damage to the Hunter over 2 turns, while RDU evened up the life totals. So now RDU has the initiative for face hits.
Okay.
Yeah, but I think Eloise has... the thing is, like, 2 of her minions die right away, and it's all about how RDU plays this. Because if he tries to get all the minions down to 2 health...
Face! What do you mean how he plays this? Easy play. Face.
No.
So dead within 2 turns?
Yeah, you're getting dead in 2 turns. 9+9, right? So you just want to set up for Explosive Trap and just like quick shot the...
After
playing Knife Juggler, so you can just cycle.
Mm-hmm. You juggle, quick shot the Doomguard, attack the 4/4 with your 2 hounds, and then hit face with hero power.
Yeah.
The thing is, it's like, it's so weak because your face damage is, it's so low.
You can't race, Crip. You die in 2 turns.
Face.
So here, guys, we've got a classic case of Hunter.
Yes!
Kill me. Oh, my God.
Oh, no. Freezing Trap is useless.
Been so good.
The explosive triggers first, so...
No. You can just hit a minion.
Oh, right.
Yeah. You attack that 1/1 hound.
Yeah, you win the face.
Now it's all about killing that 2/1. But when you've got explosive, I guess you don't care. It's going to kill the juggler anyway, and you're just trying to race. What is RDU's favorite top deck at this point?
Oh!
Well, never mind. There might not be a top deck.
That's pretty nice.
That is insane.
How much damage is that? So he's got 9 plus another 7 if he wants it.
Oh, yeah, you want it.
He's 2 damage off of lethal, though, and then he can't tap.
You could if you're a baller.
Yeah, you can get the other Power of a Whelm, or a Doomguard, or an Abusive.
So there's 3 outs, I guess.
Or an Argus.
Argus, yeah.
Argus would win, too, yeah.
Direwolf, if you play it.
Well, she was playing the Argent Squires. Those are really good with Direwolf, so there might be one in there.
Right. Tap it.
No, it's too late now.
No, it's not too late.
It's never too late, says Amaz.
Too late. Right? We can still tap here.
The question is, what killed you then that doesn't kill you now?
If you were gonna tap, you should have done it earlier.
That's true. Well, I guess you're stuck with this hand then.
So she's gonna win next turn if things go well. I think that's a pretty decent play, but...
Oh, no!
That is not a...
Wait, actually,
She doesn't win yet.
No, it's a win, right?
No, not yet. The Freezing Trap denies it.
Freezing Trap bounces it back, and then you just replay it.
Oh my god.
No, that's right.
It's a win.
Yeah, you're right. You get 2 attacks from the...
The Doomguard costs 7. You're right.
Yeah, unfortunately, Eloise... that's right. Okay.
Yeah.
You're right. 7 mana was fine.
Yeah, there was some opportunity to screw that up, but it was not taken, fortunately.
Nope.
Good thing I wasn't playing that hand, because I think I would have autopiloted it to like just missing lethal and be like, yeah, hunters suck.
Well, I guess Mal'Ganis would have just won the game as well, right?
Kinda. I would have played Mal'Ganis. Yeah. I would have probably won with that, but yeah, I would have missed lethal too early.
Oh, seems like Eloise did win after all. And yes. The analysis kind of backfired again.
No, it's Hearthstone. You play the odds, and I think the matchups favor the hunter. So.
That definitely does. Yeah.
In the words of RDU, you know, sometimes you don't draw with the cards you need, and then even the best matchups can end up in a loss.
Mm. Yeah, you can't do too much sometimes.
Yeah.
And now Nihilum gets to the throw in their next class. What will they do?
Yep.
Do you throw Lothar in the ring? Has the time come?
In the ring.
Wait, so there's a Freeze Mage from Temple Storm, and you know it's starting to narrow down. Like you really want to target the Freeze Mage with your Druid, is my guess. Like there's really no matchup in there that you want to pick up as Thais, then Hyde's Freeze Mage.
Yeah. Well, yesterday we talked about the advantageous position of having one win on each of your three players. So maybe it's Gar's time to shine here from Temple Storm.
Yeah,
so
maybe.
What do you play to counter that? Paladin from Lothar? Just throw that in and maybe...
Can you counter it? Like, I don't think Gar is running Mech Shaman, is he?
He does run mid-range Shaman quite a bit.
Yeah.
So we'll have to see.
He's playing, like, perhaps polarized decks. He might be playing, like, an aggressive Hunter and mid-range Shaman. So you can't... I mean, it is the range that those two decks cover is just basically everything. So you can't really play into that if you... think Gara's going to play. I think we're still at the stage where you just throw out a deck right now.
Okay.
Well, what about Hunter from RDU? Like, at worst, it's a coin flip, so you just try that again? Like,
really?
Against Gara, isn't it?
You want to perhaps bench your Patron Warrior?
Oh. That's never good.
You know what, Crip? No.
Yeah.
Well, the Freeze Mage would be against Druid, though. You'd be okay with that.
But Tizer's Druid is more of the Ancient of War style.
Well, no, it runs in... I think a lot of Druids nowadays, even the...
Yeah, they just...
mid-range
just
ones,
they
just sprinkle it in.
Right.
Yeah, they just get a little bit more time to get their combo pieces with that card in the deck.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Still double combo, though, but then losing the Shade early on, you know...
Yeah, it's playing one Shade, one Ancient, I think, from what we saw last game.
Right.
So, yeah, it's splitting between... the two poles of what the deck usually does.
Wow. Same guys again.
Druid versus Paladin.
Okay. Now, I don't actually know how this works with the aggressive Paladin, but we were saying how the control Paladins have been doing better in the tournament. If it is a control Paladin, the chance of the Paladin winning is fairly low, I feel, just because it applies no pressure and the Druid just draws just like the Super Saiyan like 30 damage combo thing and... Okay. Yeah, bad things happen. That's usually how the Paladin works out, I feel, in the mid-rangey Pally.
Really?
Yeah.
I think mid-range Paladin versus Druid is amazing for Paladin.
For the Paladin, I think it's usually a bit better than for the Druid player. Because Druid can't really handle, like, unless you get a swipe exactly when you need it, you can get blown out of the board very quickly. And the Shielded Minibot is such a pesky minion.
Yeah. But we really don't know what Eloise is playing. It's just that Druids either remove your board or they establish a minion, right? And with Paladin's consistency of dropping something on 2, dropping something on 3, 4, etc., it's really hard to deal with both.
I have to guess that Eloise is playing an aggressive Paladin. Aggro Pally is considered one of the better decks in the meta right now. And last week, Eloise is playing Freeze Mage and I think Handlock. So if they're going to make her switch, I think they're going to make her switch to a deck that has been... putting up decent results lately.
It's pretty difficult, actually, to play aggro Paladin, in my opinion.
It's pretty what, sorry?
It's pretty difficult, because you have to be counting a lot, right? You only have, like, X amount of damage, and, you know, you got to get those silences at the right time. And sometimes you don't even play Consecrate, right? So there's a lot of, like, deck choice decision when you actually pilot that deck.
Yeah, but it's kind of funny to see that it's, like, one... I think at the moment it's in... one of the better spots metagame-wise than it's ever been. Like, you know, it used to be a deck that was mostly, you know, an early season grinder. Like, you'd take that to grind the ladder nonstop, but now it actually counters a few decks very effectively. So, I wonder if we'll see improvements to the deck further down the line with the new cards that are coming out. There's a possibility for that deck to still stay alive.
More aggro cards?
No, more aggro cards. Maybe, like, refinements on the existing Ebola Din. God, please, no. Oh, God.
Oh,
Okay. All right, well, the match is being kicked off here. Looks like he does a pretty aggressive paladin deck.
Yeah.
That's still a good matchup for the pally. Like, it's in those 65
matchup for the pally. I don't know. I feel like the slow paladin decks, and I think mid-range paladin is a slow deck.
Yep, kind of.
I think you just give the druid just a lot of time, even though a lot of things trade favorably. Giving the druid time basically leads to a loss so frequently, and I think the aggressive paladin just takes the time back.
Oh man, Shredder Opener.
Shredder Opener to Hero Part is pretty sweet against this board.
This is one of the few decks against which this works, just because there's so little like contest the Shredder at this point. Like, he can't just negate it. There's no way for Eloise to deal with this at all.
Oh yeah, there is. Face.
Always the face. As long as Eloise draws an answer for the Ancient of War that's going to come up, I think it's fine.
Equality. The thing is, does every one of those decks run double equality?
No, actually,
because you've got, like, against aggro. Well, sometimes you play it. I think it's
sometimes they run one, I think. But I think double equality is really rare.
Yeah, you don't want to draw them.
And yeah, if you just draw double equality, you instantly lose. So.
Well, I think you usually play a single one no matter what, and the second copy is added against control. Like, if you're expecting to face off against control decks,
okay.
But it's a bit of a... I think the deck is still in its refinement stage. Like, a lot of people have come up with a list that works very well, but it's still not completely set in stone, and that's a nice card to see.
Yeah, even with weird cards like Arden Protector, you don't see it in every single aggressive paladin list, right?
Yeah, not at all, actually. It's very unusual. Like, even when you tech it against aggro, you still don't see it too often.
I still don't think you play it, though, because you don't really want to play your deckhand here, do you?
Oh, I guess you do. Anything that puts power on the board is a play.
And you can go face for more damage,
now,
and
why
then you
is
have
it...
another...
Oh, no. Yo, we're right. This is the best play, because, like, what's the chance your Lepronome loses Divine Shield? It's basically zero. So if your Lepronome keeps a Divine Shield, then your King's play is...
Well, it's losing Divine Shield.
This King's is going nowhere.
It's still not going to lose Divine Shield. You're going to play the Shade.
Yeah, no, it's going to lose the Divine Shield by attacking.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, wow. What a sick outcome for Thais.
Never mind
that.
But then, no, you have to keep the Owl for the Ancient of War and the Belcher that's going to come. So
You can't. Oh, my God. Well,
This is not the type of deck that you keep cards, I don't believe.
Yeah, you wanted to get that Divine Favor out ASAP. So you punch face and you hope there's no answer. If there's a swipe, then so be it. What can you do?
Oh man, that Enorchar was so clutch. You know, something like us, 6 health taunt would have been better than Enorchar, right? You could just have cleared it and pushed for 2 damage instead.
Right. Just go face here for sure.
Okay.
You could kill the Noyotron if you think there's a swipe, but
no.
That way your Divine Shield stays safe.
There's no way you...
Oh. Yeah, because your Divine Shield, you're at least going to keep one of the minions as Divine Shielded if there's a swipe. And then you have a target for Kings.
That's a pretty good card as well.
That's a really badly timed card, though, because I think you have to play that this turn, and then you get Kings the following turn.
Oh, but then you would get Belcher afterwards, right? So it doesn't matter. I think you need to just deal with the board ASAP, and Keeper is the way to do it.
Okay. Well, yeah, Keeper on the Lepronome seems to be the best course of action then.
Unless you think you're gonna get swipes later, but not really.
Yeah, yeah, that is unfortunately not very consistent.
So I mean, the Paladin really didn't accomplish much.
Not yet.
It's only done. Yeah, I mean, it can push for 8 damage here, I guess. But if you don't get a Divine Favor, you're not really going to push for much more than that in this game.
Yep, I agree with that.
Oh, this is just not good. Number one, you can't curve that juggle with the Kings. And if you Kings, the Belcher is just... Like, unless you top deck the Owl, you're going to get double taunted up. So she doesn't know that yet. So.
You obviously Kings the Divine Shield and go face. Because if Thais is... Like, he already used one Wrath. So if he's going to Hero Power down a 6-6 Divine Shield, you're okay with that.
Mm-hmm.
That's pushing for 12. Yeah, I think Lepronome just finishes the Shade off just because it's really insane. And then King's face.
Okay. What's good about that too is that if a Druid of the Claw gets dropped, you could take it out easily. Like, the Belcher is more aggravating in this case, but going blind as Eloise, you think Druid of the Claw is not going to be an issue for the shielded mini bot?
Yeah. So, King's Face, I guess. It deals 4 damage to the face and still develops your board.
Yep.
Force of nature. That is really good too. So Eloise needs basically what? Divine Favor to bounce back. That's it.
Owl first, I think.
Owl first.
Yeah, you get the owl first and then divine. Yeah, it's very specific, but I can hardly see how else she gets out of this, because even True Server Champion doesn't accomplish anything. Equality does nothing unless Knife Juggler pops the
Equality does much worse than nothing.
Yeah, exactly. It's kind of
That's pretty good though, okay. The Consecrate.
Yeah. Get rid of the slime.
I don't know if you play it this turn though.
So you just pop the Belcher and Knife Juggler hero power? Because the thing is, if you top deck Divine Favor, you need to be able to draw as many cards as you can.
Yeah, that's true. But also, if you play Equality, Consecrate's the only way that you can use it.
I demand the deck list, so I know if there's an Equality in there.
I just think that if you play the Juggler, you want a dude. And yeah. You can get a better Consecrate than this.
No.
Right.
It still forces, in this case, it still forces the force of nature.
Yeah,
forces the force of nature, okay.
I'm trying not to be too repetitively redundant here.
And this is really a game of how soon can you draw Divine Favor. That's all this is right now.
Yeah. How entertaining. Are you not entertained? Oh, not a bad top deck. That's 8 damage, but without an owl, this... Ancient of War is not going to do much.
You really wanted like an extra mana crystal here to push for a board and with the True Silver.
You could still play the Juggler if you kill the 2/1. The problem is if you do that, it does like absolutely nothing. At
definitely
all.
Not.
No.
Yeah.
4 mana super fireball to the face.
Yeah. Yeah, well, True Silver is a really good face card if you think about it. It's 4 mana. Yeah, it does 8 damage, but you also gain 4. So it's like a 12 damage swing for 4 mana. You compare that to Holy Fire, it's like significantly better.
Yep, pretty insane. Is this a silence? No.
No, but it's phase damage when it dies.
True. So it's like a, 2/1 to charge the phase.
Yeah, but like the Druid doesn't really need more cards. So, I mean, the Druid essentially has the 5 health from the lore, 3 taunt creatures, Savage Roar to finish the game if things start going well. It's pretty rough for Eloise here.
Nope, Knife Juggler agrees with the face though.
Wow.
That's consistent with the game plan.
Yeah, that's for sure.
So here we're gonna see Equality top deck into Avenging Wrath top deck.
Oh, Avenging Wrath would be sick. It's lethal, right? Avenging Wrath? Yeah. 8 to the face, Leprechaun.
Yeah, it would be hilarious to actually see like a Divine Favor here popping up Equality and Avenging Wrath together.
Oh man.
It looks like Tice is going aggro mode here. And he's going to get really punished if Equality is drawn, but Equality first has to be in the deck, and we haven't really established that yet.
Yeah.
I think he's just going to losing cards, so that Divine Favor is like not that good if she just draw it.
Yeah, sure.
Ooh, that's a trade into the 4/6. Unless you want to get rid of the 5/7 now. What do you kill? Because the thing is, if you trade for the 5/7, you lose the minion.
You kill the 4/6 because your minion just lives. If you kill the 5/7, your minion dies.
Yeah, and there's no way that Taj is going to use this phase to clear the Leopard Gnome, right?
So right.
It kills 2 things.
Yeah. Pretty easy. I think.
Yep.
Some hesitation. There we go.
But I mean, obviously, you're not comfortable at this position, right? Just 5/7 taunt.
I wonder if the questioning was, do I attack the 5/7, and then that way, if I top deck Consecration number 2, I can attack into the Druid of the Claw and finish it off with Consec.
Because
now that 5/7 is pretty much immune to.
Well, I think she's thinking about that one attack here.
Mm-hmm.
And goes right. Good. Yeah. I like it.
Swipe's an issue, so you might as well just get the minions out of the way while you can.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that's a good Leper Gnome.
Yeah, Leper Gnome.
I like the Emperor here, even though it's a bit risky. Just because if you do Emperor, next turn you can do Druid of the Claw and Ancient of Lore.
And Tides are Grace of you. Not that risky, right?
Not really. Like, you have to get punished by, like, Divine Favor into a Silence.
Ooh.
Into, like, Arcane Golem, right? Like, that would have to be exactly the cards.
Yeah, and you still have a heal by then, so...
No, you would
heal. No, you would die right away, but for the time being... Yeah, okay, that second heal is just going to seal it. So, actually, a Blessing of Might on top of that would work. Well, you need Owl, Golem, and Blessing of Might. Oh man, that'd be crazy.
Yeah.
No, just Owl, Golem, because you have four from the True Silver. He's at 8.
But even with this heal, like, would that work? If you sprinkle in a bit more damage? Equality is, like, the only way to win. It has to be basically Divine Favor into Equality into Consec or something along those lines.
Well, let's see. Silence, double Arcane Golem off of Divine Favor still works.
No. That's a zero damage card.
Yeah.
Yep. Ty's just gonna get this one back and tie this one for Nihilum.
Yep. Back and forth games. I mean, that's kind of what we expected. Ty's gets the check mark, but, yeah. I think it's a bit vulnerable here when you have two players that have yet to win any games, because you're very limited in what you can play, and I mean that just has to do with the benching rule,
mm-hmm.
where you know after you lose one, you don't feel good about playing that same player again, but sometimes you just have to.
Yeah, sometimes when you're playing around the bench rule to avoid it, the other team can catch on to something too, and they can expect something extra from the way you trends and whatnot, right? Patterns. So definitely not good to be on two players rather than three players, but still, a win is a win, and you gotta get those wins.
It's interesting. Yeah. There's somebody who's tweeting about Spectral Knight. Like, you talked about it earlier. They're saying implosions everywhere, so they really like playing it in Druid.
Well, Spectral Knight used to be a thing because back when it was played, people were still playing very spell-heavy rogue decks, and they were very popular. So the Innervate Spectral Knight turn one would be the instant concede against the rogues.
Let me sap this. Oh, wait.
Yeah. Okay. So that was a lot of fun. But speaking about the teams here, even though the teams are evened out 2-2, I do prefer the position Tempestorm is in, just because of the fact that they're not potentially as punished by the bench rule as Nihilum would be.
Yeah, makes sense. I mean, if I was Tempestorm and I was facing Nihilums, Lothar, and RDU, every time they lose a game, I'm going to expect them to just switch players, right?
Yeah.
Because the bench rule is just so so punishing.
When you have two players that haven't won any games,
exactly
that bench rule is like maxed out right now.
Yeah, but it's pretty good for Thais that he managed to get the Druid out of the way without even having to face the favorable matchup. Like, I think Thais right now in the league, he's at like 5 wins and 4 losses with Druid, or 6-4 or 5-3, something along those lines. But he's got a positive win rate, which is arguably the best that anybody's managed in the league so far. Going back to the fact that we talked about that a bit earlier, so it's kind of impressive to see that even though a lot of people disagree with Druid being picked up, he still manages to get the wins, even in a bad spot like this one against Paladin.
Mm-hmm. Tice also did very well last week. Tice 2-0'd last week, while RDU and Life Coach each dropped 2 games. So, but that's kind of expected. I think RDU kind of has a fairly poor win ratio, but it doesn't really describe the full picture of what's going on. He's always the one stuck with the less than ideal decks, having to close out the last game, and it's much harder to win those than it is to win the first few.
Yeah. There was 1 week I think Life Coach took that the off deck, so to speak, and he lost twice with it before he won it, so had a bit of trouble with it too.
Mm-hmm. If you're just looking at the stats alone, might seem like RDU is like not performing as well. But if you're looking at watching the show, you can see that, oh wow, RDU is actually, like, you know, might be sealing the deal for Nihilum. Mm-hmm. Every single time.
Yeah, I remember in the early first weeks he had, I think the first week was a really rough one for him, and that's when he started talking about how different it was when you're forced to win for your team. You're not winning for yourself. You know, you can handle your own losses, but when it comes to a team format, then he felt a lot of pressure, but, you know, the teammates were really supportive.
Isn't that the thing, though? Like, if you lose your own games, you feel slightly less bad, but if you lose a game and you kind of have to hurt your teammates, that just feels like so much more pressure, so much... You just don't want to fail, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That little bit of extra pressure can get to you. Early on in competitive Hearthstone, it was certainly like that.
Played in the matches, right? What is this called?
Yeah.
Fight Nights? Yeah, exactly. Fight Nights. And, oh my god.
Whoa, that sketch of Lothar is amazing. Holy cow.
I am a Photoshop master.
Oh man. Yeah. So Lothar once again is something for life coach.
You know what? They should have taken a picture. Okay, did you guys catch his stream this morning? He was role playing as life coach and he literally roped every single turn for all of his stream. And now that he's replacing him in the league, I think it's very fitting. But they should have taken a picture from him the early stream we had today.
Okay. I just caught the end of that VOD because it was on Reddit, and Lothar actually climbed like Legend 13 or something like
that. Yeah, he was like almost in the top 10 legend playing patron and thinking every turn through for 75 seconds.
That's exactly my point. You know, deliberately thinking out every single turn in the maximum duration. There might be something to that, you know?
Please. We need, we need.
Oh my god,
not
life coaches on the left. Oh my god.
Yep.
What am I looking at?
Lothar coach. All right.
Okay.
Well, how about the Void Terror? I always liked that card. There's always fun interactions with it.
Yeah. But you don't keep it. If you don't have something else to go along with it, you need a 2-drop.
But what are you searching for, ideally, like against a mate? Are you looking for Nerubian Eggs or more for Knife Drillers?
Any 2-drop, really.
The thing is, Nerubian Egg, I mean, you know, Hype's probably praying a freeze... Freeze Mage, so the Nerubian Egg is good, just not popped. Maybe even better.
Yeah, as a protection, kind of like against Explosive Trap or Hunter. It's the same idea. Well, but no 2-drop, unfortunately.
The Power Overwhelm Void Terror combo is actually one that does dominate the Freeze Mage, but this is not a Freeze Mage.
It's a Blinktron one.
Yeah.
Blinktron Mech Mage.
Which was, I think, I almost want to say pioneered by Reynad in a tournament a long time ago. I'm not sure if it came into quote-unquote the mainstream before he played it.
I think this deck was actually pioneered by anyone who bought more than 30 packs in GVG.
Mech Mage with Blinktron?
Yeah.
The Mech Mage? Okay, I remember Blinktron in all sorts of funky decks, but in Mech Mage it's...
Oh, come on. Everybody played this. This is the first deck anyone made after
I didn't like Mech Mage. I thought it was boring. Oh well.
Oh, Flame Imp. I guess it's good to rope that turn because sometimes
he's role playing.
Sergeant is maybe a little bit better than Flame Imp against the Mage on turn one, or not. You know, whatever.
Nice, sick.
All right.
At least I'm not lost right now. I can actually, like, I'm not confused. It still feels like it's a life coach. I'm not gonna have a psychosis midstream for confusion purposes.
All right, so what about this play, though?
Double one drop, for sure.
Oh.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
Because the Mage is all about, like, getting ahead. So if you just play too slow, you're never going to be ahead against Zoo. You're just always going to lose, and you're never going to win that game. It's, like, totally possible.
Makes sense. Voidwalker is pretty good here. Protect the Flame Imp from the from anything, really. It's just going to be a ping next turn.
Well, that's the question, really. Do you really want to attack into the 1-2 for value? Because it's so weird, because if you play Voidwalker and you don't kill the 1-2, mech comes out, you lose the Void.
Yeah.
So it's either way.
You have to kill the 1-2 here. It's just, like, such a good value trade.
You force a ping, basically, and get a trade with your...
It's also that you don't get totally wrecked by Frostbolt as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Yeah, because otherwise the Mana Worm would just take out two minions on its own, and you'd lose the Flame Imp.
And he'd still have basically a 3-2 the next turn.
Yeah.
Do you play the Abusive, though, as well?
again, like, you know it's Mech Mage right now, and you know how Mech Mage wins, so yes, everyone is playing all their stuff as fast as possible.
Okay.
Well, I think he might actually go face. I don't like... Oh, there we go.
No, let's not do that. The more aggressive...
He was just thinking about it. Like, whenever they just keep thinking about it, I'm like, wow, is he really going to do that, you know?
No, it's just thinking it turns through, but...
I think it's a case of cosplay, but...
Yeah.
Those glasses, though.
I think those are women's glasses.
Oh.
They're like too big and round.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or unisex glasses. They exist.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to ping. If you play the Snow Chugger, it basically dies to the creature that you otherwise ping. So, drawing a card for nothing, it's pretty nice.
Mm-hmm. Attacking here also makes sense. Otherwise, like, abusive or something would really hurt.
But it's abusive is going to hurt if you attack either way. But it's just the hand played one would be worse.
Well, no, actually, if you don't hit and the abusive comes down, you actually don't trade for anything. This actually guarantees at least a minion trade.
Yeah, at least one kill, exactly.
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
With the hand, yeah, it looks...
Void Terror time? Sweet. Yeah, if there's a Void Terror, it'd be really sweet.
Yeah, I mean, Mech Mage does not run removal. It runs basically cards that hit face that can sometimes, if you have no other choice, kill creatures.
So what do you think about the choice from Temple Storm overall to bring Mech Mage to the tournament? Is it that powerful of a deck? Because I know that Tempo Mage, you know, minion base mage, is falling out of favor due to its inconsistency.
Yeah, I mean, we see here that Freeze Mage should have been just sick against Zoo, right? And there's just so many good matchups that after Patron and Hunter, Freeze Mage is just good against everything. So maybe they feel like, you know, kind of mixing things around.
Also, I'm not so sure how well Mech Mage does against Patron Warrior. It feels like with the life gain, you kind of gain a lot of extra turns as the Patron, and once like Grim Patron hits the board, and you can't even play like some of the cards. Like, you can't even play Goblin Blast Mage.
Right, you kind of need some Flame Strike techs, or like even this deck, right? You can freeze the opponent's face, Blinktron your opponent's weapon, stuff like
Holy
that.
Holy cow! Look at that.
Yeah, that's
that is insane.
That's really good. So let's just summon the 4/4 right now, clear your opponent's board, and just play an egg behind it. Argus next turn. It's gonna be pretty sick.
That's all about the positioning. So let's give him 75 seconds to think about where he wants to put the egg.
Actually, the play is to wait 75 seconds and then make that play.
Oh man.
Yeah, you would have misplayed him, Oz.
You
would have finished your turn in like 5 seconds.
Too fast.
Sometimes. See, Lothar really wants to play it, but he's like, oh, I gotta stay in character.
Yeah. Stay in character? I don't see Lothar.
Yeah.
Alright. Well, I guess... How you guys doing? You guys doing good?
Alright, now he can go. Now Lothar can go.
And now he's trying not to crack up, which is the best part. He's doing a pretty good job of it, because I couldn't. Oh, man.
I think it's important to play the egg in the middle, isn't it?
I guess it depends where he wants to. I think ultimately he wants to buff up the Voidwalker.
Aye.
Either way. Well, in his mind, that's what he's looking to do.
Mm.
And if it doesn't work, then he's just going to move the egg to the center with the Nurubian, so it kind of adds up to the same thing.
Sure, but this makes more sense if he plays Direwolf, right? You want to play Deathrouse on the side?
Sure,
on the side,
yeah. Okay. Now we're talking about Blinktron. Blinktron's a card that's really good if you're winning, which kind of works with this type of deck,
right?
Where it really, really, really works if you're winning. The flip side of that is it really sucks if you're losing. So right now Hype is losing, and he's losing pretty badly as Lothar managed to get those two eggs, activators for both. It's pretty crushing. There's not really too much that you can do as the mage here.
And the curve is awful too, because if you play Snowchugger Ping now, you might be able to freeze the Nurubian, let's say, but your turn 5 consists of what? A 3-drop and another ping? And if you want to keep the Snowchugger for the Blast Mage, it means you're playing a 3-drop this turn, which dies to the Nurubian. So everything you do is just a little off.
Yeah.
Gotta choose the worst one. I mean, the best worst one.
The best bad.
Yep.
Ooh. Oh,
wow. Slam dunk.
No, I think the Argus is.
I like
better.
The Argus, yeah.
Argus is really good, but then. Yeah, I guess you played the Argus just so the thing is, has something, you know.
Look, what about you buff the Nerubian to prevent the pings? Because the opponent's plan here is probably to follow it up with a three drop.
You do have
to
do that. You do have. That's why I think the egg in the middle was important. You're gonna have to buff the Nerubian, and now Blintron's gonna come down. He's gonna get the Doom Hammer, and it's gonna be game over.
Oh, is that how it works?
Yeah, that's how it works.
The punish. Okay, let's see.
And before there's a glitch, and somebody gets the supercharged hammer from the Shaman class.
Oh wow.
Triple call.
What are the odds here? So you're looking at a 1 in 5 twice run four times. Those are not great odds, but I think it's
existent.
Yeah, it's not.
Yeah, 0.016. It's horrible,
Doom,
man.
It's better than Doomhammer.
Yeah.
Is it though? Doomhammer is like there's only like what 10 weapons in the game, right?
No, I think it's more than that. Paladin.
Yeah, there's a Paladin on its own has like 4.
Sure,
Rogue
let's say
has
20,
like 4.
Okay? So that's still 5%. The juggles here need to be like so precise. I'm pretty sure that's not 5%.
No, they don't need to be that precise. No, they just need to kill the 5-2. They just need to kill the 5-2. And if they kill the 5-2, the chance that it also pops the egg is really low.
Even slim, yeah. Because I think it's like it's 0.2-ish, or like under that for one target.
Here we go.
Nice job, Blast Mage.
No,
you're a terrible Blast Mage.
Yeah, that was a terrible Blast Mage. Thing.
No. Learn to esports, Blast Mage.
Well. Wow, this is the fastest turn yet.
Oh, yeah. What a misplay.
So many possibilities.
Do you want to play deliberately into Blizzard? Do you want to like get really efficient trades? No, Doomguard into 5-4, Argus into 2-1.
There's no Blizzard in this deck. No way.
But you have to expect there's some weird tech choices if you're running up against Mech Mage. I don't think you have the no way argument.
No way. No way. You play Flamestrike instead of Blizzard, right? Okay. Because it's like a patron kind of thing.
Right.
And, like, freezing the minions doesn't freeze the face. And, like, I would expect, like, War Elementals and stuff like that, but never Blizzard.
In this deck, I think Water Elemental is... Like, I know Reynad used to play that specific deck, and it ran Water Elementals. Okay, so he's vulnerable, possibly, to a 2-drop plus Blast Mage. If there's another Blast Mage from the top, but...
So it's...
At the moment.
It's Doomhammer time, I guess.
Doomhammer time.
Well, you still have a Fireball Ping, I guess, and you only take 7 damage next turn. Is it that bad?
If you Fireball Ping, you're always losing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you can't ever make those plays with this deck. You have to make risky plays when you're losing.
Well, how about just hide the fact that you have.
But how does Doomhammer even save you? Like, yeah. I'm not even sure it helps.
Yeah, I mean, you just might die. There's like 14 damage on the board. Your opponent gets a 5 attack weapon, or even a 3 attack weapon plus 2 damage.
Yeah, that's true.
So maybe just concede and like go on to the next game, not reveal your tech.
Well, what about Snowchugga and the.
Town.
Maybe you get like a freeze or a taunt spare part.
Okay, yeah, I could see that. That's probably the most consistent game plan. As ridiculous as it sounds to say that like a 15% spare part is the best, I think it might just be.
Yeah, you got 2, but gonna go.
Also, a flip is pretty good too.
Yeah, you're negating about 3 damage.
But then how do you remove it afterwards?
Surprised they killed that one.
Oof!
Oh no. Oh wow, Pain of Doom as well.
So you pop your own egg. Come on, please, man. Let it be real.
No, you don't do that.
He has to kill the Snow Trigger.
You board turn and pop your own egg, and then you just Pain of Doom the face later, right? 2 damage.
No, you can't have Pain of Doom without popping the Snow Trigger. You don't understand.
Okay.
Okay, wait, no. This is not Life Coach.
That's a good one. Senjin.
This would have been useful a little earlier, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So Blinktron, get Gladiator's Longbow, kill it 3-5, Frostbolt to 5-2, give him a life justice.
Wait, what did
my god.
That is
That's good. Not good.
That's a good egg popper. I heard you like popping eggs, Crip.
And what's the weapon on the other side?
Looks like Eaglehorn bow to me.
Yeah.
No, actually, it's not. It can't be.
There's no lightning.
Perdition's Blade, maybe, because it doesn't have the lightning thing.
No, I think it's actually an Arcana Reaper.
Oh, I saw. Wow. Yeah, it could be Reaper. Could be Perdition's Blade. Could be.
That's Perdition.
It's a 2/2.
It's Perdition's. Yeah.
There's got to be Perdition's. There's another 2/2 weapon. Is there? The Argent Lance. Let it not be a good card.
The Ogre Maul ended up being pretty good there, at least.
It killed something.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I like this. Abuse of the Egg, Void Terror, the Egg.
Yep, that would be really good. And you want to keep as many bodies on the board, obviously, because there's a Ogre weapon over there.
Mm-hmm. Oh no, sorry. You wait another 30 seconds and then you Abuse of the Egg and then you Void Terror the Egg and then you go all face.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good play.
I like the waiting part. I think it's a really good way to demoralize your opponent.
Oh, so that's what Life Coach does.
I mean, it's true. It kind of does have that effect. Whenever someone is going like turn one, going first, and then 70 seconds later, they flame imp.
No, you don't understand. You know how often I've conceded. I have conceded so many times to that exact play.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's game. I don't think you can get out of this hyped. Luthor's going to take a game here. And by the way, for the ATLC, if you ever get a sub, your record is actually added to the original player's record. So Life Coach is actually going to get a win here.
Okay, not bad. Hyped is not gonna get a win. Hyped is 1-1 for the day. So, well, I'm sure Kibler's happy.
Yep, looking at the Master of Duels, it's gonna be a Dragon Trophy.
Who's the third behind those two? Was that?
I think it's pretty close. I think there's quite a ball of players around there.
Okay.
I know that Kibler was way ahead before he lost two games back to back.
Yeah, Chalky is actually really close with like a 10-5. So that's pretty close.
It's pretty close. Now that Hype lost another one, I think he's at 10-4.
That's true. Kibler's going to play later today, so we'll see how he does. There's always a chance that a person loses 6 games in a row, right?
Yeah, it could be really devastating for Kibler if things don't go his way. Yeah. So maybe there was like an internal discussion at Value Town. Hey, can I please get all the good decks? You guys take the rest. I'll split the winnings. Special tactics.
All right, well, RDU still has not seen much play yet, but he does have 2 very premium decks. So, I mean, leaving him last with those two classes seems like a pretty reasonable strategy to me.
Premium decks is a very good term. I like that.
I mean, aren't those like cream of the crop there?
It's pretty much, yeah. The top
mid-range Hunter and Patron.
Yeah, that would probably be... I mean, I guess if you had to pick 2 top decks, they would probably be those. The thing is, like, RDU's been playing hybrid as well, not just mid-range. Although I guess you could shove them in the same category since they do have a somewhat similar playstyle at times.
They both hunt alone.
Okay.
I forget Illyria's Battlecry. You know, it's probably one of the heroes I've seen the least.
Yeah. All right. For Tempo Storm side, Hype losing a game with that deck. Actually, like, what does that beat? It probably beats the Paladin pretty well if it draws really well.
Does it beat Patron? We discussed this. It doesn't, right? After the Patron cycle comes through?
It beats anything if you just get a ridiculous hand. But I don't
know. You get a Chugger the Styx against that Patron, and you... Whoa, we're going to see it.
Yeah, we're going to see it right away. Okay, good.
That's cool. It's just that a lot of the cards just become really bad later on. It feels like it might be pretty decent against the Patron with the Blingtron nullifying Deathspite and... perhaps not giving him another death spite, though sometimes that happens.
Yeah, that might happen sometimes. Or even like giving your opponent like a Gorehowl would kind of suck, right? But I guess you have like a lot of freeze minions, so it does kind of make sense as well.
Yeah, that's the idea.
I'm curious to know if Hype plays Harrison Jones and Mech Mage, because it's a tech that's been included in a lot of variants of mech.
Oh, I think you do, because you play Blingtron. So
yeah.
It's kind of like a easy include there.
Turn 10 combo. And then Think Master Hemet, let's do this.
hey, isn't that what everybody thought of when Bling Chun was first announced? It's like, oh, Bling Chun Harrison. That's insane.
Yeah, you get card draw and you get a weapon.
Yeah.
And you override, of course, your opponent's weapon. You know, everything working out perfectly.
Dream situations.
Yeah, it's the go-to combo when you play 30 legendary decks.
You know what's hilarious, though? If that new 5-mana 3-3 makes Hemet playable.
What 5-mana 3-3?
The one that gives you...
The Ram Wrangler. It gives you a random beast.
Okay.
You haven't seen it?
Yeah, I've seen it, but how does that make Hemet playable?
Because you can curve Hemet right afterwards and kill the beast. And then you trade with a 3-3. It's a 1-for-1.
Yeah, 1-for-1. It's insane. No. Insane.
Amaz doesn't believe. All right, you know what, Amaz?
I thought you were actually, I thought I was missing something. I was like, what?
No, but it works. It's a 1-for-1. It kind of...
Yeah, okay.
Yep. All right.
So here's a very good start for RDU.
Okay.
And Hype's Inertron is actually going to work out pretty well. Do you think you're going to Inner Rage and just clear off this Inertron before like a Tinkertown comes out?
That doesn't feel good at all.
Yeah, but then you have two. And then it's all about board, right? You usually just lose to getting...
Yeah, RDU's in pain right now. He's in labor pain over this Inertron.
Oh. His face is pretty funny.
Yeah.
I would be really scared of the Tinkertown.
I would be too. I think because you have the armor up afterwards, you're just taking 2 damage anyways, right? So I feel like it's fine. You've got to remove stuff.
It's just like the Inner Rage is so good with Acolyte.
Yeah, but you have 2, right? You have 2. So just
2 for the Acolyte. Exactly.
No, you don't want a 2 for the Acolyte. You just want a 1 because you get pinged. That's really bad.
Alright, so he's not going to do it. He's going to try to get a card draw later.
Oh man, this is a very aggressive hand for Hive. There's going to be a low theft curve belt as well, and RDU's in trouble.
Yeah, he's going to start losing pretty badly here.
Maybe not so much. I mean, it really depends what this whirlwind ends up doing. Because theoretically, he could still pull off like a crazy turn if he wants to.
I mean, I guess he could clear the board, but like...
I guess the best option here is just to play the shield block or defrothing.
I like the Acolyte.
I think you want an Acolyte with the Whirlwind and the Inner Rage, right?
Oh, you mean all at the same time?
Yeah.
So if you play the Frothing, it kind of challenges the... it might challenge actually both the Divine Shield and the Spider Tank, because the Mage will often try to play out maximum mana turns. Yeah, actually I think the Frothing is really good. Because the Mage is not likely to ping.
Wait, could you actually just Inner Rage the Inertron now and then hit it? Or is that not worth it?
Well, if you didn't do it last turn, then doing this turn means you made a mistake, exactly. Right?
Yeah.
And Hearthstone players never make mistakes.
Never.
True fact.
Especially with Grim Patron Warrior.
Never miss lethal.
You always play that deck flawlessly every time.
Yeah, well, the good thing with it is that nobody can really say that you did misplay, because you can just say, oh, it's such a refined deck, everybody has their own playstyle.
Yeah,
you can always bring up that argument.
I like Blast Mage here because you push for so much damage.
And just give him the cards.
Yeah, just give him the cards. Whatever. He already drew a card. He's gonna draw another one, so just give him one more. You know.
All right. Yeah, I'm kind of torn. I'm not.
You're torn.
Yeah, I feel like the 3/4 denying one card is all right as well.
But you push 3 damage. Is bad, though. Like you're on a clock. You need to kill your opponent before they patron you.
No, you push 1 damage because it ate 2 blast hits.
Oh, I guess. But then your Spire Tank just, you know, dies to like a whirlwind, and then you lose the 3 damage.
It's such a slow curve for RDU. I mean, it's not even slow. It's just the way that it plays. But against this tempo, you can feel just how slow it is. So I guess you want to go Frothing Whirlwind, kill the Inertron, and see what happens. You hope there's no Frostbolt and no Fireball. That way, maybe you have a chance of staying in the game, if that Frothing can trade.
Yep. But then the Lothab is not really the best thing that RDU wants to see right now, because both of these guys would probably go to face.
Well, Lothab also denies an Execute top deck.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of 8 damage to the face is a lot.
Actually, do you Lothab or do you Snowchugger and then
I'd probably just trade Spider Tank and play Lothab here.
Really?
Yeah, no, that's 7/3 kills my Lothab, so I lose out more damage, I guess.
Oh man, I just want the damage now.
Oh my god, crit. He's going for the double minion play?
Yeah.
You're right.
It's just a lot worse later on.
That makes sense, I guess.
Lothab's fine at every stage of the game. It's just about playing around Execute, so... I mean, you saw already you play a Frothing instead of Execute, so you know he doesn't have it.
Mm-hmm.
He will get punished if RDU draws... Yep, there you go.
Okay. Of course, right? Of course.
Yeah, of course. We have to make these games exciting in some way.
Yeah.
Yep.
Don't miss this might be the comeback turn, or like the beginning of a comeback for RDU.
Yeah. So, well, I mean, I liked Hype's play, but he did get punished for it, and now he might lose. So that kind of sucks for him.
Oh, I guess Lothab is still very, very strong, right?
Mm-hmm.
This might be better on stable with Tinkertown.
Yeah, I like unstable Tinkertown more than Lothab.
So what are you looking to unstable? Blast Mage?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, that'd be like flawless. Now no weapon use for RDU, which I guess might be what Hyped was hoping for when he made the play that he did. And this isn't looking very... Actually, is this it? Like, do you have to go Warsong Frothing to stay alive?
Probably, actually. Just kill off the spider tank.
So, wow.
It's all about, horrible. Like, Borden, right? You're not going to kill him with, like, the 30 damage combo now. You're just going to lose because you have no more time.
Yeah, you're going to win when the mage runs out of cards because your armor up is going to beat almost every top deck.
If he could inner rage here, he'd get a pretty good turn, but because he can't, it's really locking out of possibilities.
Yeah, just Warsong and Frothing. Use the Gnomish and hit the Snow Chugger, and then that's just enough damage to kill the Spirit Tank. Gotta do what you
got. But then you're still frozen, and you, the thing is, it's all about getting that shield block off without being dead at the exact moment where it's played. So he's 6 off lethal, I guess.
Fireball does it.
Fireball is lethal.
No.
Leroy Jenkins is lethal.
Also a few of the Chargers. I think a Reckless Rocketeer would also be lethal here.
Yeah, with the ping, it would also work.
So you're saying that there's a lot of chances.
There's two out of like
it's basically guaranteed.
Yeah. Oh, basically guaranteed. Actually,
it's Windspeaker. There we go. Bam.
Oh, even four here. Yeah, right. Yeah.
Yeah, Windspeaker's good.
Ragnaros.
What else are we looking at? Yeah, Rag for a random hit. That would also work.
Yeah.
Surely there's something else. Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Please.
Come on.
Please do it.
Unstable Portal's going to put one of those cards that we just said. Oh, and it's going to get punished. Oh, that's actually, no. Cloakfield is really good.
Now, though, Hyped is worried.
About?
I'm not sure.
I guess Shield Block is really good for RDU.
Yeah, Shield Block is a game-winning card for RDU.
He's mostly worried about the Warsong Commander. He just can't leave that on the board.
Yeah.
Oh man, missing so much damage! Painful.
Do you even stealth a Snow Chugger?
You can't. Have mana.
Alright.
And this is. Oh my god!
This is
Shield Slam.
Life Coach has built this deck, it feels, because he. I mean, I've seen him play Shield Slam and Control and Patron Warrior a bit more than other players. This is such a good top deck for RDU. Now all he needs is to top deck the execute, and he's
another
gonna be
shield slam, maybe?
Fully golden.
Yeah, another slam would work.
Oh, that's good too.
Oh, not this turn though.
So let's.
Is that good? It's like not good enough right now.
Okay, wait. Do you actually kill the Snow Chugger off, or do you
You slam inner rage, try
just
to
deny
find
the damage.
Yeah, I guess you're in survival mode right now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, makes sense, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, the moment you get the Armorsmith out, there's a good chance you can stay alive and stay in the game.
Yeah, but you still can't use your weapon, so that's...
Alright, King Crush, here we go, bam.
Alec here, let's do this. Uh-oh.
Oh, even better!
Wow. So
that's pretty much it, right?
Even better.
Yeah.
That's a good game.
That is basically game.
Hype is pretty happy about that.
He's pretty hypey? What?
Yeah, that.
Is this how you do well in Archon Team League?
You know, it's so far.
One of the ways.
Okay. It's one of the multiple methods you can employ to get at the top of the ladder.
I'm just gonna hate to see this. No. Oh, man.
So you're telling me he gets one spare part, and this is it. Well, yes, RD.
Hey, we also had an answer, too, to the board.
Yeah. It's not good enough.
Brutal. That's it.
Is it not? You play Acolyte Warsong? Could you find...
Yeah, you could get Warwind. You can play...
So how much? Wait, how much damage does Hype have? He's got 17, right? How much armor can you get at most?
With 2 mana, not much.
Yeah.
You need a Warwind, basically. But then you're still facing 2 fireballs again.
Well, you gain 2 armor with that play. So is that enough? 16?
No, it's not. You need 17. You need 18 to win.
You need 18 to survive.
Oh, wow. That's gonna do it. Stealth Antonetus. And that's what it takes to beat a patron. Not that hard.
Yeah. Happens all the time. Good choice from Hype.
Yeah, that was a great choice. I mean, when he got offered all those spare parts and he selected the Finicky Cloakfield, I'd say that was a pretty game-winning choice. And imagine if he'd actually stealthed that minion we mentioned earlier. Because we said, oh, does he stealth? There's no turn, the weapon locked. Yeah.
It would not have worked out so well.
No, not in this case. It actually was a game-winning top deck that worked perfectly well with the Cloakfield. Well, I guess that's going to equalize the series again. It seems like we're going to go up to a 6-5 at this rate. One of the teams winning by a small margin. It might come down to, like, a very weird matchup for one of the teams, and an unfavored one.
A lot of the decks that are left are fairly known. I know the Aggro Pally is like an up and coming deck, so maybe not that, but I think it's still pretty refined. The only deck that I think has that question mark on it is Garra's Shaman.
It always has, doesn't it? Garra's Shaman is always a question mark for me because I know the outlines of it, but I've got literally no clue exactly what he puts in. He tends to come up with really wild variants of it, and as a result, I think he's like a really underestimated deck builder. Although I guess some of his deck choices in the past have, you know, they kind of left him out to dry.
Yeah, but when you're bringing like a new deck to every other tournament, some of them are just not going to pan out very well.
Yeah, like that Metaltooth Leaper Hunter I remember from Garra. You might have not seen that, but that was just really weird. Like a mech hunter, but with the usual array of cards. I think it was after GVG. He tried to like Undertaker Hybrid with mech warpers and stuff. It was kind of weird.
Yeah, it sounds completely weird and probably terrible. I think a lot of us have tried mech in every single class, and there's a reason there's not too many mech hunters on the ladder. But I think for a short amount of time, it was okay just because Undertaker was so insane.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could get carried by those games, and then you think the Metaltooth Leaper is doing it, but it's really the Undertaker.
Yeah, and yeah, if you haven't played Hearthstone for very long, Undertaker used to be really, really broken, and there was some crossover between GVG and Undertaker being broken, where the game was not particularly fun to play, but
understatement of the year.
Yeah, fortunately, the devs took care of that issue, and now Hearthstone's a lot of fun.
A lot of fun,
as it turns out.
Everyone, get in here and play Hearthstone.
I like that. I like this.
You know, I really loved it initially. I was actually casting the Kinguin League when the Patron deck kind of started being played. And I had a lot of fun. I looked at it as the Freeze Mage of Warrior, and I just loved that about it. But now that it's still kind of the undefeated deck. Back then it was unrefined. Now that it's refined to no end, it really feels like it's taking a bit of the diversity out of the metagame by forcing metagame cycles to be very quick.
Well, we might say just that, because I don't believe mid-range Shaman has a very fun experience against the Grim Patron Warrior. But watching someone be miserable in a matchup against the Grim Patron is still quite exciting.
All right, but we don't even know for sure if it's a mid-range Shaman, right?
Yeah, it could be a really good matchup with a mech Shaman. Yeah. Yep.
And the hands are going to be... Oh,
mech with the curve. This is crazy.
Oh, man.
There we go.
Call this the curve because you're getting to 2-drop.
No War Axe is going to be very punishing for RDO. It might just be a repeat of the series just now where the Mech Mage just stampeded across RDU.
That'll teach RDU to play good decks, you know?
Not quite, though.
Oh, whoa, okay.
Well, it's not too bad, though, because you've got 2 4-drops back-to-back with a Hex in case you really need to handle something like a Frothing that's played for tempo. That bad.
What's the Hex doing there? That's interesting.
I'm telling you, Garra's probably running Frost Shock just to stop patrons. Like that's Garra in a nutshell. Like that's just how I perceive him as a deck builder. He's going out of his way to make things work that nobody would try. And sometimes it takes you off guard, and it's enough to suddenly make the card look like it's viable.
All right. Well, the Yeti may be better than the Shredder because it doesn't die immediately to a Deathbite.
Yep.
But it does die eventually to a Deathbite, so I don't know.
That's pretty rough. The Whirlwind plus the Deathbite AoE is very often enough to...
Ooh, already face tanking 4 there. It does have two Whirlwind effects, so that should be fine.
Oh.
It's an investment, right? Ooh, Doomhammer with Rockbiter. Now that's going to hurt later.
All right, so do you play Fire Guard here? Just no. Because, you know, it doesn't really die, or does it die to execute?
No, it would die. You don't want to overload, I think. You want to play Doomhammer on 5 and then Fire Guard on 6, right?
Because that makes sense.
You have 4 mana on 6.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
And Gaara's in, like, he's on the way to already win just based on the hand that he's got. Because between Doomhammer, Rockbiter, and the Lava Burst, he's doing more than fine. Okay, so Doomsayer comes out.
No. Whirling Sap-O-Matic.
Let it be real.
Oh, yeah.
I want to see this. It's always the Crazed Alchemist. In the past 2 Shredders I've casted,
yeah,
I'm disappointed.
Quite a bit. Oh, there's so much damage!
Yeah.
Wait, is this 4. Lethal already?
With lucky hits, he's going to be one off.
5 and with 6 and 2. No,
Yeah. So just Doomhammer, I guess?
Doomhammer, I guess.
Sounds good to me. Wow. Now, the only thing you don't want to see here is Armor Smith played with Warsong and a Whirlwind. That's like the only thing you really don't want to see.
I think it's even fine. Because, like, it's, yeah, you're winning, just too you're much
winning pretty much next turn. This is over.
Yeah.
There's no way you come out of this. Like,
Battle Rage into Shield Block could make it look like...
Yeah, that's one out, I guess.
You have 3 card draws to find a Shield Block.
Yeah.
You can Battle Rage again.
No, you can't. No.
Yeah.
You're at 10 cards. You can cycle if you want.
Oh. Wow, RDU just got completely blown out by the Shaman. Although that's kind of what Mech Shaman does if they get a semi-decent curve. And that Cogmaster really just putting down a minion on the board, killing the Acolyte of Pain right away.
Yeah. Gaara has at the very least 13 damage here, so it is enough.
Well, fastest game ever in ATOC.
Actually, wait. Shiblock wouldn't have even done it.
Yeah, no. it would have given him a glimpse of maybe surviving, is what were my words. So I guess ultimately there was no way for RDU to get out of this one.
Well, and I guess RDU is benched because he lost twice. And that is going to maybe play a big factor.
Paladin has to come out. That's it. There's one deck. You can target it as much as you want. You play Mage and you win.
The Mage is through already, right?
From Hype. Yeah, you're right. He got the check mark. Well, what do you play against Lothar? You don't know what Paladin is.
You don't know what Paladin is, but I think if you're trying something new, you're going to try something that you know kind of works in the meta right now. So I would just expect an aggressive Paladin.
Okay.
But,
okay.
I mean, with the way this has worked out, with RDU benched, Thice having the check mark, even though Tempestorm still has to win 2, Lothar has to play the Paladin until it wins a game.
So at best, it's got a mirror match against the aggro Pally versus, like, against Eloise, or Gaara ends up unleashing against the Silverhand recruits.
Oh yeah, Hunter is so good against aggro Pally.
It's just like, I think in most of the weeks that we've seen Gaara bring Hunter, it's always been like a little weird. And I think that weird factor is often going to be a liability against the refined aggressive Paladin deck.
Really? I think Deathlord Hunter is actually pretty good against aggro Pally. You put a 2/8, they can't do anything about it. And just see it go.
I love Deathlord Hunter.
Did I miss that sometimes? Like,
you didn't see... For a while, I think Deathlord in the Hunter deck was one of the most... For like about 2 weeks straight, I think you had like a really Deathlord heavy Hunter meta on the top of the ladder.
Wow.
Because so many Hunter decks were switching to aggro and hybrid. And so other Hunters said, well, you know what? I'm going to put Deathlord in my mid-range and, you know, deal with it. And it just won every single time. And then Hunter's Marks came back in, yada yada. Typical metagame switches.
If you look at it away, Deathlord kind of says Death Rattles deal 1 damage to your opponent, right? Because it gives you 1 more Hound.
Mm. But, yeah. I still think, like, okay. Let's say Garrett is bringing Deathlord Hunter, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Which is possible. Very possible.
You can still crush that with Kings.
And oh yeah, you can. I don't think it's a problem for aggro Pally as much as it was for the aggro hunter.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you could, but you can have reverse crush with like freezing trap and like hunter smart.
I think it's the true sword champions that really nail it, because it comes on turn three. That's then you true. Might be able to curve like with enough damage plus the true silver, and if you get an arcane golem for free, then you can still like keep punching. There's a few ways in which it's less strong against aggro Pally, equality being one of them, of course, mm-hmm. in some of the variants. So it's all about whether or not Lothar even runs that in his deck, and if he's even running aggro Pally, like we don't know yet.
Alright.
It's a toss-up.
In the Paladin matchups, usually the faster Paladin deck just wins a considerable amount of the time.
Mm-hmm.
So, yep, Eloise's deck was pretty fast. I don't know if it gets much faster than that.
Arden Squires and whatnot, yep.
I didn't see Elven Archer, so I think there's a way to improve the speed.
Oh, man.
You play Raging Worgens with Elven Archers, and then you crop up. Yeah, you put up the kings on the worgen and win.
Okay, Lothar's hand looks pretty.
Is that Lothar's hand?
Yeah,
it is. Oh, it is Lothar's hand. Wow, yeah, that's an insane hand. I don't know.
Like exactly the same as Eloise's, right? That we saw before.
I don't even know if you mulligan any of that.
No, why do you keep this? This is insane.
Muster with the South Sea.
It's the deck hand that you think about. Like, do you want to keep the deck hand?
Yeah. Well, with Muster, I think it's fine, really.
Wow, over on the other side is pretty insane as well.
Might be better, actually.
No, the thing is, I think going second is a bad thing if
you get a one drop, right?
Yeah, if you get a good one drop.
Oh my god. Speaking of one drop. Now the problem with this is that Lothar's board, even though it might be more aggressive, is also not going to be as consistent. So I think one of the situations we might see arise is that Lothar is looking for Divine Favor somewhat early. Because there are going to be almost dead cards in this matchup, but Eloise is more likely to hold on to her quote-unquote expensive curve in this case.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's true. And whatever Lothar drops...
Whoa, misplay, no Ralph! What?
Okay, I think Eloise actually has the upper hand here.
Yeah, of course. I mean, Inarichan is just insane. So, yeah. And I think you do play Inarichan.
No.
Just, why?
No, you play Inarichan when you're getting True Silver to face.
Oh, man, that's true too. But you don't want this to get Blessing and you hit for face, you know?
Yeah, Blessing of Might is a really big problem early on. It reminds me of the old Cold
Silence. Sounds to follow. Blessing of Might does 3 damage anyway. Like, whenever you play that card, you attack with the creature. So, you don't care about that. You don't taunt 1 health. Alright.
Okay, sure. Makes sense.
Oh! That's a really good find for Lothar. It's the only turn he's ever going to get to play it, so...
If he decides to play it later.
There's no way he doesn't play it, drop. I think, right?
Double like, one drop, let's do it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I guess,
Yeah, I think now we're gonna see Inarichan.
Yeah.
Then that's gonna force Lothar to play Muster, and there's a chance that Eloise can dump her 2 drops by turn 4. And this doesn't matter nearly as much. Oh, wow.
Oh, how about another one?
Eloise is good.
Hmm. Yeah, I like the Inarichan.
Well,
it's gonna get
Lothar
a little punished
the initiative. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely Muster here.
If Lothar can draw one drop next turn, he'll be in terrific shape.
He's drawn a lot of them, though. But yeah, there's a chance that he has, you know, Worgen Infiltrators, possibly. And then the copies of what he's already played.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure that some of these Paladin lists actually cut Consecration.
So yeah, definitely.
That might be a problem. But Eloise, we know that she's at least running one.
Yeah, Consecrate is a great card.
So my question is, do you trade here just because you're afraid of Blessings? And well, it turns out yes. I was going to say, like, afraid of Blessings and the Argent Protector that you saw earlier from Scouting.
Mm-hmm. But Reverse Muster here is just going to be... It's just going to be a kill fest here for both players.
If Lothar picks up the one drop, this is going to be a blowout. Oh my goodness.
Oh wow, that's insane. I guess the other good card would have been Argus, but this is good enough too.
Yeah, this is really nice.
Good enough? Because like, what if he draws a Kings? No, it doesn't matter because Owl.
I mean, that was good enough to have Eloise reposition in her seat. mean.
Oh my god, the juggler is there, and there's a South Sea Kings.
South Sea Kings is a charging.
I like the South Sea Kings a lot.
Jeez, that's pretty insane.
It is, but it's two cards for five mana, so I mean, it's all right.
So, what do you feel about Owl Argent Protector? It doesn't die to your to the Light's Justice, or do you just prefer Shielded Minibot and the 1/1 to use the 1/1 to the weapon?
I like the Argent Protector. You're not going to see too much value because most of the creatures are super tiny.
Okay.
You might even play the Hero Power Argent Protector instead, right?
Hero Power Argent Protector.
Yeah. All right.
If you play just the naked 1/1 here, just dies to the weapon. It's kind of like
Oh simple. Man, they switched the stats around. You would have gotten a 2/2 without Divine Shield. Oh, this juggler could do a lot of work. And you empty your hand, no chance of a semi-decent Divine Favor ever. You're only weak to Consecration. Which is, again, a big weakness here. Like, it's a really big weakness, but I feel like you've got to go all in.
You can also play Hero Power instead.
I think you Hero Power instead of the Worgen here.
Yeah.
Or instead of the South Sea? Because you want to keep the South Sea for Kings? Maybe not.
Maybe just Hero Power first to see if you get a decent juggle here. Because if you Hero Power and you hit juggle's face, then you have to play the South Sea. Yeah, you have to play the South Sea now.
And there's no real answer to this.
Oh my god, that sucks. That really sucks.
Eloise is pretty happy about that one.
Her face is... No, she repositioned in her seat, but I think she's reconsidering. She's perfectly fine here. Okay. Well, there's like... There's a contest for that juggler, but it's not that bad. What if Eloise decides to go for Arcane Golem with Argent Protector to kill that 3-2?
What if you just silence and Divine Shield?
A silencing would be pretty terrible, actually.
Because there's no buffs yet, right? So you kind of need that Owl. I mentioned earlier, she could have played it on something just for the body, but the 1-1 was obviously better because the silence is so much more valuable.
Well, you can clear. I think because there are so much buffing opportunities in these decks that perhaps the Arcane Golem Divine Shield might be the best play here.
Okay. Yeah, it might be because like you don't really care about mana crystals, right? It's just all about, like, playing
cards. 3 cards, right? Exactly. Like three cards are playable on 6 mana anyway.
Oh no. Oh. Might see a little bit of a punish here.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is definitely a punish. And it's a pretty big one at that, actually. I'm a little surprised.
Yeah, Silence Kings is just insane here.
And Lothar still stands to get a minute amount of value from Divine Favor down the line, whereas Eloise is locked out of it. There's zero ways that that's even remotely possible. And now Lothar's got to be considering, if I silence, I make the same mistake she just did, which is not silence a buff, right?
Oh man, I guess.
Yeah, but in his case, it's just so good.
You want to protect
your... Because you're forcing a trade. If she does buff, then she's trading to the juggler, so you're still ahead.
Right. Just want to protect your minion.
You're also winning a lot on the life lead, so even if she kills the owl for free, taking 2 damage is fine. Like, you'd be okay with that.
Is there a world where you do not play Blessing of Kings this turn and just play all your creatures and Hero Power?
Okay. Well, the silence juggler, I don't know. And the consecration that you know is in Eloise's deck, I don't think so.
I think you know there's 2 of them in her deck, which is pretty threatening. Didn't we see 2 of them in her?
No, we only saw one.
Just the one.
Just
yeah.
One.
But 7 damage is really sick, and Eloise is gonna have to...
Oh!
Never mind, she's gonna have to nothing at all. In fact, there may be a full clear.
What was that?
The Arcane Golem.
Really? Yeah. 7 damage to a minion? Oh man, that does not feel good at all.
Yeah, I think Life Coach is off his game.
I think he needs more time.
That was insane.
Well, if that kills the owl, this is just...
One more chance.
Oh, how does Lothar climb back in? How does Lothar climb back in?
I don't think you play the Abusive here.
Okay.
She's played very conservatively with her cards. Like, she's tried to save up her cards. So, that's how she's played the whole game up to now. And that's
true. Okay.
That's not really consistent.
You can also play Abusive next turn and get a juggle off that way, too.
And look at that juggler. Like, whatever Lothar plays could just get sniped.
Oof.
Oh, well, never.
Here we go.
Never mind. Yeah. Esports moment at its best. It hit face twice 50, earlier, 50. So it's got 50, the redeem. 50.
Three chances.
Arcane missiles.
Arcane missiles. Yeah.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah. That's a good start.
Really? Oh, uh-oh. Now it's a 50-50 again.
Oh my god. And consecration is top decked. Is it? No, it's not. Oh, that's still sick though. Oh my god. I would cry. This is almost too good to be true.
I think you just deckhand here.
Mm-hmm. Deckhand a hero power.
If it is the juggler, it's kind of sick.
You deckhand and kill the juggler. Oh.
Oh god.
I think you might as well just dude now to have a low chance of hitting face.
Eloise is just like, ooh, that's a good one. I guess they're all the same, but still. but still, okay, it's right. A good one.
Really didn't want to hit that juggler.
Oh, Death Star is a level 50 rogue. He plays rogue.
What?
You didn't see the little pop-up at the bottom? It said Death Star was a level 50 rogue.
Okay, no.
Primarily plays Hunter, so no surprise.
Well, with both players out of cards, I think face damage is not really relevant.
Yeah, I don't think face damage is relevant either. You just want to clear the board, but...
Never mind.
Like, I think I would have true-silvered the 1-1 there.
And
you can go face with the juggler, that's fine, because he's going to attack into your juggler.
Right. You go face with your minions, and you always clear minions with your face, right?
Yeah.
And now the thing is, it's a matter of balancing how likely you think it is that they have buffs to make this even worse.
Oh, apparently Lothar thinks it's very likely.
Yeah.
But then you have the owl as well, so that's kind of weird. Oh, yeah. Wow!
Tempo!
Wow. When's the last time you've seen this? Oh, wow.
Okay.
This is insane. They have to hit face, otherwise that's game, right?
Yeah.
And even if it hits face, it still almost doesn't matter. They have to be as bad as Lothar's juggles were.
If this kills the owl, it's a really big deal. No, it doesn't.
Just chop the owl down.
The top deck consec for Lothar. Divine Favor is like the worst card in the universe. Nice.
That's pretty bad.
That's pretty bad.
Yeah, I think Consecration is what.
And now Eloise is going to get Divine Favor, right? Oh, okay. Oh. Way better.
Temple Owl is just horrible, right? You look at this Blessing of Kings and you think to yourself, why did I ever owl?
Oh, that is just so painful.
Yeah.
I feel like this whole game was reliant on the jugglers.
Yeah, it's one of the. Well, I think juggler is one of those cards that some people have a gripe with because of the way that it works and the fact that it's actually competitive, right? Like, it's good while being very random at times when you get like four triggers and then.
I like how Eloise is like really happy right now.
She's singing to herself.
I would love an equality consecrate. Like, whenever I see that, oh my god.
Oh, you just want to punish? But
yeah. Okay. But no, it's not happening.
Nope. And Temple Storm grabs their fifth win, and it's going to be on match point.
Yep, that's right. Still targeting Lothar, though.
Yeah, are you still benched?
There's not much to target. I mean, it's only Garo with one deck.
Right, and it's a great deck, too. Yeah. We're talking Hunter versus Paladin.
Well, he didn't lead with it.
That's
so
true.
Maybe it's not as good as we think it might be. We'll have to see. But it's been going really well for Tempo Storm. I think they were down in the set earlier. Now they're considerably ahead. They're on match point. And they might kind of squeeze into that top two position in the standings at the end of the stage one of Archon Team League here. If Tempo Storm gets this win, they're going to be at four wins. They're gonna actually have the same record as Nihilum, which is currently the number one team.
Yeah, 4-1. I think Nihilum could still end up much lower in the standings if they lose today and their next match next week, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, yeah, Temple Storm winning this will also tie them with Cloud9, so it will basically be a three-way tie, well, at least in terms of like Series 1. So 4-2 for Nihilum, Cloud9, and Temple Storm, and we only have two spots for the finale, so...
Actually,
the finale, yeah.
In terms of the... in terms of the wins versus losses standings, the point differential, all three teams before this match were at +5. So if Tempo Storm beats Nihilum, they would automatically be first, actually.
Yeah, that actually makes sense. Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. And it's also a big deal that Nihilum gets four losses at least. in this specific set, because if you look at the game wins, in this case, if they lose now and they win next week, if they got four losses here, then they're guaranteed to be top two. Mm-hmm. Pretty much, no matter what.
All right, potentially the last game for Temple Storm. They want to seal this out, and of course, Lothar wants to win, so RDO can at least play some of his games out and maybe grab a win before the end of the day.
Yeah, winning three in a row against the Hunter is very tough no matter what you play. It's the type of deck that can just snowball and steal games no matter what you try. Yeah. Let's hope Gaara's not too experimental this time.
Return of the... I don't even know what that's called. Mechanized Leaper or something?
The Metal Tooth
Leaper. Saber Tooth or something?
Metal Tooth.
Oh, Metal Tooth. Oh my god. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. It is like that like Power Ranger Zord thing, right?
pretty much.
Yeah, it's the yellow Power Ranger Zord. Oh man. So cool.
You play all five of them, you just kill your opponent.
The thing is, on paper, that card is so sick. It's like a permanent Savage Roar to all the mechs. But then you actually try to get mechs on the board to stick as a hunter, and you realize that's just a horrible card.
No, I mean, they're fine. I mean, they're as good as mage cards, but it turns out hunter cards are just better than those.
And it's the only mech from hunter, right? Other classes have two mechs each, but hunter's like the only class with one mech.
I think several classes have only one mech, right?
Well, Screwgen, Clunker, Siege Engine, Iron Juggernaut, that's three there.
Some classes also have just really bad ones. Like, Paladins have the 6-3 for 5.
Yeah, but at least they have choices, right? Hunter is
that's not a choice, though.
Oh, it's a choice, Kirk. It's a choice.
They have Shield of Minibot to compensate for any bad card they might have gotten, so I guess. This is a pretty decent hand from Lothar's side.
Very sick hand.
Yeah, we have to see what Gaara picks up, because this could be... They're both wearing glasses. I don't know if this is the battle of the glasses or what. Gaara always wears them, but not Life Coach.
Yeah, I mean, the glare from your screen can be pretty brutal if you're staring at it for 20 hours a day. So, yeah. You got to protect yourself. You know, it's important.
Mm.
Okay. Right, I feel like I've heard this somewhere.
Alright,
even better, Argent Squire, huh? Argent Squire with
you go maybe with Squire Worgen, Squire Worgen, just to protect yourself against possibly a web spinner. I mean, you have no real idea about what Gaara's playing.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Seems pretty normal right now from Gaara's hand.
So, is there an argument for coining out Shield Minibot because you can kill Mad Scientist and the Juggler with it?
That's also interesting, too.
But then you get wrecked by Haunted Creeper.
That's true. But then,
you have to play the two minions that have to attack, basically, I think. If you're going to coin out anything here, it's got to be like the two small ones that can kill Juggler and Mad Scientist.
Okay, that makes sense, too.
And it also allows you to trigger the trap right now so you can keep developing things.
Oh, this looks like a pretty hybrid-y hunter from Gaara with the Shredder and the Leopard Gnome.
Yeah, he favors that a lot.
Yep.
Okay. Divine Fever is not going to get much value right away, but... Perhaps a little bit later. Oh no! Never mind. That's
it's not gonna get bad. Yeah.
You'd really prefer that would be an explosive.
But at least it's not too bad. From like the thing is, if this is Leok or Misha,
Huffer is the worst.
Yeah.
Oh.
Always Huffer. Always. In this case, it works out for the. Oh
my god.
Oh Jesus. Okay, this game is still gonna go
really
on.
Really bad cards.
You have to start. You have to play that Worgen now, right? Or do you play Muster now? Because that way the Juggler Unleash is less likely to trigger. Because maybe you can trade some of those 1/1s away by turn 5.
I just think Muster is a lot more aggressive. You just go with the aggressive play every time, basically.
And then you play a Worgen Argent Squire next turn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then the Divine Favors are just sitting there.
Oh, or maybe you just dump a Divine Favor for like one or two cards. I mean, you're not really losing much because a Worgen doesn't impact the board that much.
Yeah, it does to a juggle with Unleash, so...
And 3 mana, do nothing.
No, I might draw a card. Cycle your deck. That's effective in some cases.
Okay, yeah, sure. Makes sense.
If Gaara picks up an Unleash... I think he's going to be in a great spot. Like, the moment he picks it up, he's going to be in a great spot. For now, though, I think he's playing from behind quite heavily.
Mm-hmm. So, do you trade off these 1/1s because you fear the Unleashed Juggler? Not Juggler Unleashed?
Well, that was the initial thought, right, behind playing the Muster now, is that way you're guaranteeing that you can trade them away before the Juggler punishes you.
But do you
win the game if you do that?
Mm-hmm. That's the question.
Six damage if you go face.
Mm-hmm. I kind of like the face. I mean, I think it's a stage where you're just not happy. You got to take some risks. I mean, you just go for it.
I guess if you're saying to yourself, if Gar has Juggler Unleashed, you can't win this matchup anyways, right?
Right.
Yeah, it's already lost. You're going in with a really terrible matchup in the first place, so...
The thing is, you lose just to Unleash.
Mm-hmm.
You don't actually need to get Juggler Unleashed, so that makes it a little bit tough decision. Yeah. That makes it an actual decision.
Well, gonna play some more stuff, so Divine Face, hopefully.
Full face, I see. That's what I see the arrows being dragged up and up and up.
Well, we can tell from our side, knowing both hands, it is in fact a winning play right now, but Unleash is going to be drawn 100% of the time here.
100%?
Yep.
Wow. What? What?
Welcome to Skillstone. I think you played too much Arena Crypt. You need to stop influencing this metagame.
Oh my god. Crypt, you need to, like, you know, make a video on how you do these 100%, man. People need to learn.
Well, you just throw that every time, and then people will cherry-pick the ones that you win, and then eventually, you're gonna be right. Like, a large enough percentage of the time...
I don't think that's how it works. Like, I'm sure, like, psychology has something like that, but no, it's not how it works. It happens every single time.
You know how lucky that was? That didn't hit face a single time with a juggle. Not even once.
Yeah, it killed everything that it had to... Oh!
Is that even good, though?
Well, it's better than nothing. What's your alternative?
Yeah, it's not that it's good. It's that it's like necessary.
Oh man!
So Vitality Totem is coming. Oh my god!
Oh my god!
Oh, this game!
Oh no!
What is even happening?
Oh,
wow. This is an esports match if I've ever seen one.
Actually, I don't know if I like the abusive. I think I liked Leprenum Hero Power. Fifth.
Doesn't matter.
We're still analyzing the match, guys.
I was out after the Unleashed top deck, but I guess...
Yeah, Leopard Gnome would have been better, you know.
Lothar can play, like, back-to-back Divine Favor and draw nothing.
Actually, he could clear the board.
Oh, no.
What? Oh, like, yeah, not the Vitality, of course, but he could clear, like, the Golem and the 2-1.
Okay. And then you die, right?
Oh, no. It could still work.
Oh, yeah, that's true, because Leprenum was not playing. No.
Close enough.
Rip.
Well, I guess this was a very, very quick series.
The loss is on you, Krip. You absolutely did not have to call that Unleash.
Commentator's curse, man. That was not necessary.
That seems reasonable. I mean, it's just what you do. You top deck Unleash with Juggler in hand every time, always.
Well, I think there's a correlation between the amount of times where you have Knife Juggler and nothing to do with it, and the times where you suddenly tap like Unleash.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like the old Buzzard thing. You have Buzzard, but no Unleash, and then suddenly you get the Unleash and win the game.
Well, that's going to do it. Tempo Storm does take another pretty decisive series last week. They ran over Team Liquid 6-1. This week, not quite as crushing of a victory. But 6-3 is still very decisive. Often when a team wins in the Archon Team League, they win much more marginally than that. And there we see the standings.
They're equal.
They're exactly updated. Oh, man.
Equal.
Killam and Temple Storm are dead even. And actually, if they are dead even across all stats, Temple Storm is going to win. Because they
the point
were...
differential, right?
No, not the if the point differential is exactly the same... Temple Storm still goes ahead of Nihilim because of the
head-to-head.
Yeah, the head-to-head. Yeah, okay.
Exactly. So,
okay.
Well, one thing to note, Nihilim really had to get four wins in their match loss to guarantee a top two spot if they win the next series next week. So by losing 6-3, they might actually get pushed out of the top two even if they win next week. So this was like Lothar being... forced to play as Paladin to unbench RDU was really a big problem for them at the end there.
Yeah. Things did not work out for Nihilim too well, but I mean, if you're kind of, they're not exactly tied for first, but you know, they're in a very good position right now still.
Yeah.
You know, their lead so far in this tournament gives them, you know, some leeway. You can lose a few and still do pretty well. So pretty good stuff.
Yeah,
very enjoyable games. We are going to take a little bit of a break here before we get into our next set. We will be seeing Liquid versus Value Town when we come back. We'll sap Amaz and bring in Hyped. Oh, sorry about that. You weren't informed? Oh.
No, I actually made that decision, but still, it hurts to show that. But yeah. It's fun casting you guys once again.
Yeah, it was quite good. Before we head off to the break, big shout out to our sponsors for making the tournament happen. We have Alpha Draft, of course. I'll tell you guys about the promotion after the next set, and of course the Amazon App Store. They also have a promotion going on for you guys. They're giving away some discount codes and.